会议现在正式开始，让我们掌声有请会议主持人登台。
Okay, so ladies and gentlemen, all our distinguished guests, good afternoon. Welcome to the fifth WLA Forum, the WLA Laboratory CRS toward synthetic cells. My name is Fan Chunhai, a professor at Shanghai Jiao Tong University, and the host of today's forum. As we all know, cells are the basic unit of life. And so far, we only know very little of cells as biologists, which may seem counterintuitive to many people. But with the rapid development of synthetic biology, the questions on how cells are formed and how can we create artificial cells have been raised. This entails frontier research in design and synthesis of gene fragments, DNA molecules, gene regulation networks, cell signaling pathways, and even whole cells. With the theme of toward synthetic cells, this forum will focus on fundamental questions on natural cell structures and functions and cutting-edge technologies such as novel super-resolution imaging, cell engineering, and artificial cells, as well as perspectives in this field. This forum is hosted by the World Laureates Association and the China Association for Science and Technology, and co-hosted by WLA Laboratories, Parkland Foundation, and the Sequoia China Charity Foundation. First of all, please allow me to introduce our distinguished guests of today's forum, including online and on-site sessions. The online session, we are honored to have James Rothman. He is a Nobel laureate in physiology or medicine in 2013, a professor and the chairman of cell biology at Yale University. Erwin NEHER, Nobel laureate in physiology or medicine in 1991, direct scientific manager at Max Planck Institute for Biophysical Chemistry. Stephen Hale, Nobel laureate in chemistry in 2014, director head in the Department of Nanobiophotonics at Max Planck Institute for Multidisciplinary Sciences. Ronald VALE, Albert Lasker Award laureate in basic medical research in 2012, Vice President Howard Hughes Medical Institute, Executive Director, Engineer Research Campus. Yingjin is a member of the Chinese Academy of Sciences and the Vice President of Tianjin University. Zeng Anping, a member of German National Academy of Science and Engineering, and he is also the founding director at Westlake Center of Synthetic Biology and Integrated Bioengineering at Westlake University. Yu Huimin, he was awarded the prize Technical Invention Award laureate, the Ministry of Education, and he is a tenured professor at Tsinghua University. In the meanwhile, at a conference site, we are honored to have Xu Jinbo, tenured professor of Toyota Technological Institute at Chicago, and he is also a visiting professor of Tsinghua University. SHAO Yangyang, professor of College of Life Science, Zhejiang University. Our forum consists of three parts: keynote speech, panel discussion, and a post-award ceremony. We expect a total duration of 3 hours and 20 minutes. Okay, so let's start with today's first online keynote speaker, Professor Jim Rothman. He will give about 15 minutes presentation. Welcome, Jim.
Can I have the slides, please? Thank you. And in the slideshow mode. Okay, well, I'm very happy to be here with you today. And I think since the clock is ticking, I will just get started. You can read the title of my talk today. The next slide, please, Carol. So by way of background, vesicles constitute a prime delivery system within the cell, responsible for a variety of aspects of cell growth, division, endocrine, exocrine physiology, and also neurophysiology. And as is now well known, snare proteins consisting of one set of proteins, which we call V-snares in the vesicle membrane, and a complementary set of helical-forming proteins in the target membrane, zip up between the membranes to carry out the fusion process. And this is true for all varieties of these vesicles. What is remarkable, though, is that the time course of this fusion event is different, very different from one system to the other. And the standout case, which I'll focus on today, is the release of synaptic vesicles at nerve endings, where synchronous release, keeping pace with the action potential and information processing on a rapid scale, occurs between 0.1 and 1 millisecond after calcium enters the presynaptic zone. And as a number of people have wondered over the years, Erwin, NEHER, among them, has many times raised the point with me, how can the snare proteins, which by themselves are capable of fusing bilayers when they've on a time scale of seconds, how can they possibly carry out such a fast process of release at nerve endings? I hope to have some answers for you today. Could I have the next slide, please? Our first hint came from cryo-electron microscope tomography studies published in collaboration with my Yale colleague, Jun Lu. And what we discovered is that there are exactly we were able to apply cryo-EM to synaptic vesicles at nerve endings and in PC12 cells, and saw the same result underneath each synaptic vesicle. Unexpectedly, there were six densities distributed in a hexagonal arrangement. It's a pity that I don't have a pointer here to use. I don't think you can see my pointer, can you? It's a bit of a limitation. Oh, well. If there was a way for you to let me use the pointer, it would be really helpful. But in the absence of that, I will continue. And each of these densities is the expected size for a single snare complex with its associated synaptotagmin molecules. And so what we learned from this is that under each vesicle, there is a sort of symmetrical, highly structured arrangement of in all likelihood, snare complexes and associated proteins. And they are arranged on a ring whose diameter is about 25 to 30 nanometers. Now the idea, next slide please, that there might be a ring underneath the synaptic vesicle, I have to say was not unanticipated. Because prior to this experiment, my lab and I had developed a considerable body of evidence that the calcium sensor synaptotagmin, this is the synaptic vesicle protein discovered by Sudhoff and Yan and characterized quite brilliantly by Tom Sudhoff over the years and shown to be the calcium sensor for synchronous neurotransmitter release. We had made the unanticipated finding that this protein is a pure polypeptide, self-assembles to form planar rings of pure protein that are between 25 and 30 nanometers in diameter, about the same as the structure on which these blobs that I just showed you are arranged. We've also gone on to find that this ring-like arrangement is necessary for clamping and release. For example, having solved the structure of the synaptotagmin ring on the left, we were able to identify those residues that are present at the interface that form the contacts between adjacent C2B domains of synaptotagmin. And we were able to identify one particular mutant that we engineered. It's called, it's a phenylalanine, a critical phenylalanine at position 349. And when we mutated that, we produced a synaptotagmin that no longer formed rings in vitro. And when we tested the effects of this mutation in vivo, we observed that in hippocampal cultures, spontaneous release is greatly increased, meaning clamping is greatly diminished, and the release that was left moved from a synchronous to an asynchronous mode. So evidently, these rings are important in physiology. There's a very simple model to explain how clamping can work, because we know that synaptotagmin binds the snare pins, and you can see the helical snare pins here on the left side that are bound. And when those snare pins are restrained by the ring, they cannot complete their zip ring. But as soon as the ring disassembles with calcium, and I forgot to mention that our rings that are formed in vitro, in fact, do disassemble with calcium in the relevant concentration range, about 100 micromolar free calcium. And when that happens, we would then predict the constraint on inward movement of the snare pins will be eliminated, and fusion can then be complete. Could I have the next slide, please? So what happens to the structures that we observe underneath the synaptic vesicle when synaptotagmin wild type is replaced in hippocampal neurons or PC12 cells with this ring destabilizing mutation? On the top, you're looking at individual class averages from the cryo-electron microscopy, which have not yet been combined and which have not been, in which six-fold symmetry has not been imposed. But you can see very clearly that there are six protein structures there, and they are close to symmetric even in the class averages. When you instead have a synaptotagmin ring-forming mutant, you see similar structures, but they're no longer organized in the ring. So evidently, the snare complexes and most likely bound synaptotagmins are organized in a ring-like arrangement. And this ring-like arrangement is necessary for controlled and synchronous release. Next slide, please. So now I'd like to ask the question, how is it that a neuron can assemble exactly six snare pins? Given that there may be a synaptotagmin ring assembling, it's not hard to imagine how the snare pins might be deposited on a synaptotagmin ring, but how could there be exactly six of them? And why would they be deposited exactly with equal spacings? That becomes a problem in and of itself. Next slide, please. A simple answer came out of actually in 2017, when I looked at the structure, the X-ray structure of the key molecular chaperone, MUNC13. And what I need to give you one more bit of background. The snare proteins will self-assemble and carry out fusion spontaneously and specifically. But their self-assembly is slow. And the reason it's slow is that the membrane distal and terminal portions of the snares are designed to assemble slowly so that a molecular chaperone system is required to accelerate this assembly. The key molecular chaperone in this case is called MUNC13. And MUNC13 is labeled here. It's the outer ring. And what we noticed is that when you take the X-ray crystal structure determined by Rizzo and Sudhoff of the MUNC13 molecule, it's a curved-like structure, as they had pointed out many times. But what we did was we simply placed it end-to-end, these molecules of MUNC13, and we observed that exactly six of them form a closed ring, at least on paper. And what's more remarkable is that closed ring of MUNC13 is of a perfect size to enclose a ring of the proposed synaptotagmin, this proposed synaptotagmin ring that forms the basis of of clamping, as I just illustrated. So this got us focused on monk 13. Could I have the next slide, please? So is monk 13 capable of forming some sort of a hexameric structure? Well, this experiment demonstrates that it is. These are recent experiments of a senior scientist in my lab named Feng Li. And what we're doing here is looking down the microscope in a turf setup at supported lipid bilayers. And the supported lipid bilayers have no protein in them, but their lipid composition mimics that of the plasma membrane, and in particular contains PIP2 and about 1% or 2% mole percent diacyl glycerol. The reason to add PIP2 and diglyceride is that at one end of the monk 13 molecule is a C1 diglyceride binding domain and a C2 PIP2 and calcium binding domain that are known to be important for the association of monk 13 with the plasma membrane. And so we're looking at two images of the same field. On the left side, we're adding to the liquid above the slide pure monk 13 fluorescently labeled in one color. And in the middle, we are visualizing the diglyceride, which is fluorescently labeled. And you can see, starting with the diglyceride, that the diglyceride is inhomogeneously, that's the green, distributed within the bilayer. In fact, it forms micro domains of about 0.1 to about 0.5 microns on the average in diameter, sometimes as big as 1 micron. You'll then notice that looking on the left-hand panel, monk 13 localizes exclusively or nearly so to these diglyceride domains. So we can visualize the association of monk 13 to the diglyceride domains. The next question is, how many copies of monk 13 are there in each diglyceride domain? So to determine this, we do photo bleaching, in which we count steps, and we also measure the absolute intensity of monk 13, and we look for concordant results, which we find, that determine how many molecules of monk 13 are present on each individual diglyceride cluster. And if you look at the bottom left graph and look at the colored bars, you will see on the x-axis the number of molecules of monk 13 in the cluster, and on the y-axis, the frequency with which diglyceride clusters containing that number are found. And you'll see that there are many clusters with two or three monk 13s, but then there is a peak around 6 to 8 and another peak at a higher number. And so then the question is, next question is, evidently monk 13s are forming some sort of cluster. What type of cluster are they forming? So the simplest possibility is the null hypothesis that monk 13s are binding as individual molecules. If so, they would follow the Poisson distribution. And the Poisson distribution is shown in the dashed line in the bottom left. So you can see that these molecules are not distributing monk 13 as single molecules. They must be distributing as a cluster or some mixture of clusters. So if you look on the bottom right, we've tested the fit to the observed distribution of a series of models in which the molecular clusters of monk 13 range from 3 to 9, and you can see that the only good fit is with the number 6. And that actual fit is shown in the middle panel on the bottom, where the dashed line is theory and the solid lines are the experimental data. So our conclusion is that hexamers are the most likely oligomers that are forming on diglyceride domains. So this then begins to fit with the idea that there may be a structure of 6 molecular chaperones that limits the number of snares that can be assembled. What is that really the case functionally? Next slide, please. Now, in this experiment designed by Manindra Bera and utilizing a fully reconstituted single vesicle fusion system, we have determined the number of snare pins that are actually produced under each synaptic vesicle-like vesicle in a fully reconstituted system in a monk 13-dependent manner. So briefly to describe the system consists of a suspended bilayer of a similar composition to the one that we just used, except this bilayer mimics the plasma membrane in containing syntaxin together with monk 18, the other molecular chaperone, in the so-called closed complex, and also SNAP25, the other snare protein, on the membrane in a palmitoylated form. Monk 13 is provided in the medium, and small unilamellar vesicles containing the V-snare VAMP synaptobrevin are added. There are about 70 copies of VAMP per vesicle, and there are about 20 copies of the calcium sensor synaptotagmin also in the vesicle. So this closely mimics the situation at a nerve ending. The vesicles are fluorescent, have fluorescent lipid, and so when the vesicles bind to the suspended bilayer, we can actually see them binding, and we can count the number of docked vesicles. And these vesicles, if you were to add calcium, will go on to fuse, but we don't add calcium, so they stay in the clamped state. We then add another protein called complexin, which is well known to bind to snare complexes, but will not bind to the unassembled snares. And so wherever there is a fluorescent complexin, there is a snare pin. And this allows us to count the number of snare pins associated with each vesicle according to the number of complexins. And without going into the details, we use a mixture of labeled and unlabeled complexins in order for us to make sure that our single molecule counting procedures are self-consistent. And when we average the result of about 1,000 vesicles in 5 or 6 different experiments under various conditions, you see it highlighted in yellow that we observe 6.0 plus or minus 0.5 snare pins are formed under each synaptic vesicle, exactly as we observed from the cryotomo EM in vivo, except this is in a fully reconstituted in vitro system, and capable, by the way, of release on the millisecond scale when calcium is added. When we carry out the same experiment without Monk 13, we have a much broader range of the number of snare pins. And so this templating of the number of snare pins is in fact due to the assembly of some sort of a structure of Monk 13. What could that structure be? Next slide, please. To help determine this, my colleague, Kirill Grushin, again, a senior scientist in the laboratory, decided to study the structure of Monk 13 on lipid bilayers to see if it formed any interesting oligomeric states. Now, Monk 13 has been extensively studied in other laboratories, most notably Oxel-Brunger's laboratory, by cryo-EM and cryotomo-EM, but always at very high dilutions so that individual molecules could be seen. And this ruled out the possibility of observing oligomers that might only form at relatively high local concentrations. What Grushin observed is that when large quantities of Monk 13 were mixed with highly acidic phospholipid vesicles, crystals rapidly formed. And you're looking at the crystal on the left-hand side, at the top, a side view, and at the bottom, a top view. And these crystals are not like ordinary protein crystals that can take days to form and you have to find special conditions. These crystals literally form within seconds. It's more like a titration. You mix the lipid, you mix the protein, and you get the crystals in virtually 100% yield every time. It's quite remarkable. And if you look, you can see at the top view, it's a hexagonally packed crystal. And we've solved this crystal at high resolution. The crystal reveals that there are actually two oligomers that are present in equimolar quantities that constitute the crystal. There is an upright trimer. And I apologize again for not being able to point. It really makes it very difficult for me to give this talk and is slowing me down a bit. So I'm sorry about that. And I hope it's not making it too confusing for you. So if you look at the upright trimer, you will see below the plasma membrane, above the synaptic vesicle. That's how we interpret the two membranes. And these molecules are parallel with the C1 and C2B domains known to bind diglyceride and PIP2 in the plasma membrane at one end, and the C2C domain, which you'll see in light green, known to bind the synaptic vesicle at the other end. That's one of the two oligomers that's observed. The other is a completely different structure. We call it the lateral hexamer. It's shown in a side view and in the top view from the right-hand side of the column. And you will see that the C2C domain is arranged quite differently in that whereas the C2C domain in the upright trimer contacts the vesicle, now instead it contacts another molecule of Monk 13. And that association repeated 6 times results in this ring-like arrangement, which we, as you will see in a moment, we believe is the basis for templating exactly 6 snare pins, remembering that each Monk 13 can produce only 1 snare pin. Well, what is the relationship, if any, between the upright trimer and the lateral hexamer? And do these have any reality in physiology? Next slide, please. Of course, these could be pure crystallization artifacts, but that we now know this is not the case. We've collaborated with Jeremy Dittman at Cornell and his postdoctoral fellow, Jasmine Shahanur. And we've observed we've observed that the trimer interface, the interface that stabilizes the upright trimers, is a unique contact surface that exists that has no other known contacts in MUNC 13. And there are conserved amino acids shown encircled under trimer interface that are conserved between worms and people. Likewise, the lateral interface between C2C and MUN that stabilizes the lateral hexagon also has conserved residues also circled here on the right-hand side of the top right of the slide. And these ones are also conserved between worms and people. And the bottom shows what happens if you put those mutations into worms. And I won't have time to go through and recapitulate and explain the standard assay in worms that they are using. But in both cases, these mutations completely ablate a synaptic function in C. elegans. In fact, they are as strong as these mutations, double mutations, as strong as is the deletion of the MUNC13 gene producing the null phenotype. So there's no question that these interfaces are used in physiology, conserved in evolution, and they're therefore in all likelihood, the trimeric and lateral and hexameric structures are important. Next slide, please. So I'm now coming towards the conclusion. And what we've done now is tried to compare, and this video will iterate continuously while I'm talking. And what you see here is a series of upright trimers. And you'll see, I'm gonna wait till the video recycles again. The upright trimers are arranged into a ring of six. And that's also a feature of the crystal. We think it's likely that there are actually six upright trimers following representing a structure of 18 polypeptide chains that represents the structure that first captures the vesicle. When the vesicle is captured by this structure, it would be at a height of about 18 nanometers away from the plasma membrane bilayer, a gap of about 18 nanometers. You can see that the inner subunits of one from each of the trimers, these are the only ones that are favorably disposed to binding a synaptic vesicle. Each one will bind to make in a six-fold contact. And you will see that these can now morph through a single rigid body rotation to form the hexagon. So I want you to look at that one more time. Watch them now going from open to closed. And as they do, they form a perfect ring. And now let's watch it again. You'll see that as that happens, the purple C2B domain on the plasma membrane doesn't move at all, nor does this, you'll see it, that the only thing that moves is the MUN domain rotates. And if I could have the next slide, you'll see a single such subunit focusing now on the open and closed conformation. Open, which is upright, in fact, and now closed. As it closes, closed. And the difference between the two is a contact between the bottom of the MUN domain, which is in gray, coming now off, and now in a moment again on, the C2B domain in purple. Open now and now closed. Now I'd like you to look at one other feature. I'd like you to look at the C1 domain, which was just labeled. That's the domain that binds diglyceride. And what I'd like you to observe, watch it now, it's on the right-hand side, and now it tilts to the membrane as part of the rigid body rotation. Next slide, please. There's an important significance to this. Shown on the left is the open upright conformation, the membrane attachment to the plasma membrane. Shown on the right is the same region in the lateral hexagon arrangement closed. And now you can see very vividly, look at the C1 domain. Do you see the red dot? The red dot represents the known binding site for diglyceride. That binding site is facing 90 degrees away from the plasma membrane in the open conformer, and it is 10 angstroms above the bilayer. So there is simply no way for that C1 domain to bind to diglyceride in the bilayer, even if the diglyceride were present. But now looking on the right-hand side, in the closed conformation, the C1 domain is perfectly situated to bind a membrane-bound diglyceride. It is flush with the plasma membrane bilayer, and it is its binding surface is directly juxtaposed. So this brings us to our model for the docking and processing, next slide please, of a synaptic vesicle. And this is a working hypothesis. And what we're imagining is that a vesicle is initially captured by the upright trimers, perhaps in a more complex structure, as I indicated, involving a hexamer of trimers. We call this state one, and based on our structure, the synaptic vesicle would be about 18 nanometers away from the plasma membrane. Our structural analysis predicts that diglyceride binding is absolutely required to switch the open to the closed conformation. And you'll recall that in the experiments involving single molecule countin, we observed that when the diglyceride was present in unique islands within a bilayer, that the monk 13 bound only to those islands and was uniquely in a hexamer under those conditions. And in the same conditions, under synaptic vesicles, under synaptic vesicle mimics that were reconstituted, there was a monk 13 dependent reaction in which exactly six snare pins were produced. In state two, as we call it, the vesicle would be 12 nanometers separated from the plasma membrane. There would be a gap of 12 nanometers. We don't yet know how state two would be converted to the what we're calling state three, the readily releasable pool, which in our in vitro system is represented by the state where we count the six snare pins. We think it's unlikely that snare pins can form in state two because snare pins are physically incapable of assembling between two bilayers that are more than 9 nanometers separate, and these are 12 nanometers separate. And additionally, the C2C molecule domain in state two binds to the MUN domain and in fact covers what is known to be the active site to open the closed complex of syntaxin with MUNC18. And so in all likelihood, that structure is auto-inhibited. We think it is very likely, for reasons I can't go into, but which you'll find in our paper, that exposure to low calcium causes the C2B domain of MUNC13 to undergo a loop insertion that rotates the body of MUNC13 to close to flat against the membrane, as shown in the hypothetical structure observed in state three. And we think that the assembly of the snare complex at that stage traps the MUNC13 and snare proteins into this state, perhaps initiating the assembly of the synaptotagmin ring and forming what the physiologists call the readily releasable pool. And so again, this is a working hypothesis, but it does represent a framework for understanding both the speed of release of neurotransmitter and the process by which a remarkable choreography, which is we're beginning to reveal, I believe, ratchets the vesicle step by step along the MUNC13 molecule towards the plasma membrane to create a highly organized, highly structured, readily releasable state. Next slide, please. I just want to mention the names of a couple of people whose names I haven't mentioned. The cryo-electron tomography studies were done by Abhijit in my laboratory together with Zhen Lu. Jing Wang, when she was a postdoctoral fellow, discovered the synaptotagmin rings. Oscar Bello designed the mutations. I've mentioned Feng and Kirill Grushin and Jasmine. And a very important team in my lab, Jeff, Hong, and Diana are responsible for the protein chemistry that really underlies all of this work. So I imagine I've gone over time. I really apologize for that. My thanks for the invitation today.
Hey, thank you very much. Thank you, Professor Rothman, for your great speech. Especially the ring structure of snare pins are very impressive. Okay, so next let's connect with Professor Roland Vail to deliver his speech. Yeah, now it's about 2 or 3 a.m. in the morning, so it's very late.
Yes, greetings from Virginia, where it is almost 3 a.m. But it's a great pleasure to be talking to everyone today in this session called Towards Synthetic Cells. And today I'll be talking about a type of synthetic cell, not completely synthetic, but engineered. And it's an innate immune cell that is now being used, and it's actually in the clinic for cancer immunotherapy. So just as a background, as scientists try to understand nature, they also try to engineer or synthesize new materials of use to them. For example, even in the 17th century, there was some understanding of matter, but there was already a great desire to be able to create new materials, not very successfully through alchemy. But with an increasing understanding of the nature of matter, the nature of the chemical bond, catalysis, chemistry began to thrive. And now, as we know, with that understanding, all sorts of new chemical matter can be synthesized through predictable reactions. Now, the same, I would argue, is true for biology and cell biology. With an understanding of the cell, there have been many ways in which cells can be engineered towards productive outcomes. So these are just some examples, all of which have led to Nobel Prizes. But these include the development of hybridoma cells for making monoclonal antibodies, embryonic stem cells, which have been used for making transgenic animals. Another recent example is induced pluripotent stem cells, Shinya Yamanaka. And very recently, there's a type of cell, which is called a CAR T cell that many of you may have heard about, which is right now being used for cancer chemotherapy. And, you know, of course, I think in the coming century, we're just going to see more and more examples of engineered and maybe one day completely synthetic cells. Now, I want to talk about the CAR T cell right now and how it is being used for cancer chemotherapy. So it's really quite a remarkable process where blood is obtained from a cancer patient. And the T cells are collected, and then a new gene is introduced into these T cells ex vivo. It is called, and I'll show you what it looks like in a second, a chimeric antigen receptor. Those T cells are grown ex vivo, then returned back to the hospital where they're infused back into the patient. And these engineers T cells then are designed so that they attack cancer cells and destroy them. And the way that these this chimeric antigen receptor works is it's an engineered variant of the T cell receptor. But the extracellular domain consists of a single chain antibody that recognizes an antigen on the cancer cell. And then on the other side of this polypeptide crossing the T cell membrane are signaling domains that once the T cell is engaged with the cancer cell, a signal is then sent for the T cell to mobilize and then kill the cancer cell. Okay, so we became interested whether other cells besides T cells could be used for cancer chemotherapy. And in addition to this adaptive immune response, which is what T cells do, there's a variety of cells of the innate immune system. And one cell of great interest is the cell called a macrophage, which is involved in many reactions of clearing the body of pathogens or dying cells. So it receives signals from tissues, and it responds either by engulfing cells, which I'll show you in a second, and or involved in tissue repair, inflammation, and it also is involved in activating T cells as well by presenting antigens. So we, through basic research, were interested in this engulfment process and discovered that the receptors on the macrophage that are involved in engulfment and several of these other responses have a signaling pathway that is has many similarities to the T cell signaling pathway. And once we discovered that, we then asked, well, perhaps like CAR T therapy, we could make a chimeric antigen receptor for macrophages that could be engineered and designed to recognize a cancer cell specifically and engulf it. So this is what the chimeric antigen receptor looks like. It has an extracellular single chain antibody, then again, recognizes an antigen on a cancer cell. It then has an intracellular signaling domain that triggers this engulfment pathway. And this is work that was done by Megan Morrissey and Adam Williamson. And this just shows an example of what this engineered macrophage will do. So these are cancer cells in purple. This is the engineered macrophage that normally would not engulf this cancer cell, but with this chimeric receptor, the synthetic receptor, it will. So if you can see this in this movie, it grabs hold of a cancer cell and engulfs it. So, you know, with that basic science, became interested in whether this could actually be used clinically for cancer. And so this gave rise with several other, many other individuals to a company, which is a fairly new company called Myeloid Therapeutics. And its goal is to make designer myeloid cells for cancer chemotherapy. And these are some of the key people here. As a disclosure, I am a co-founder and shareholder. And now I want to tell you about the very interesting progress not made in my lab, but by Myeloid Therapeutics on these designer myeloid cells. So the initial work that they did was to try to take this basic design that we worked on in the lab and try to bring it into the clinic. So again, the receptor consists of these extracellular antigen binding domains and these signaling domains. These turn out to be very modular, and the company's invested a lot of time in making and sorting through antigen binders on the outside and also modifying the signaling domains on the inside. But the first work that was done was with the exact receptor that I showed you that came out of our lab. So then this gene is then introduced into monocytes and the receptor is expressed. Now, monocytes are a circulating a white blood cell that can enter tissues and then differentiate into macrophages or dendritic cells. And once this gene is introduced, ex vivo introduced back into mice, there was very promising results from tumor trials in syngeneic mice. And this just shows an example of treated mice with this engineered, the company calls it ATAC monocyte, which is effectively the one engineered with this synthetic receptor. And as you can see, there's a very good diminution of cancer progression in these mice. Now, this has been then taken to an IND, and it's in phase one clinical trials right now. So the idea here is the same, that in patients, like CAR T therapy, that you take blood, you collect the circulating monocytes now, not the T cells, you introduce the receptor, and you take these engineered monocytes, reintroduce them into the patient. Now, in this first clinical trial, it's being used for T cell lymphoma, which is a particularly interesting niche because it's hard to make a CAR T cell against working against another T cell. So in this case, the T cell lymphoma is attempted to be treated here with this ATAC monocyte. And patients are really just in the process of enrolling right now. But the first patient, at least, looks very good. There was no side effect. And actually, remarkably, this first patient is alive months after this treatment. And normally, the T-cell lymphoma is very aggressive disease. And there was a reduction in spleen size. But of course, this is just one patient. It's also a phase one trial. Really to analyze efficacy. So there's a lot of work ahead to demonstrate the efficacy. But the one difficulty of this kind of treatment also with CAR T is you have to, it's a very long, expensive process because you have to take the cells out of the patient, go to a facility, introduce the gene, reintroduce the cells back into the patient. So myeloid therapeutics began to see, well, can we actually deliver the gene, not ex vivo, but in vivo? And as everyone knows, recently from the COVID vaccine, there's really been kind of a revolution in using mRNA delivery in lipid nanoparticles. And this is what the company has really heavily invested in refining this mRNA delivery process. Now, not for a COVID vaccine, but for this engineered receptor for treating cancer. So these lipid nanoparticles then are injected directly into the body. And the idea would be that they'd be taken up by these myeloid cells, which again engulf many things, including lipid nanoparticles, and express the receptor. And then the hope would be that these engineered in vivo, in the patient engineered macrophages would target the cancer and kill it. Now, if one introduces lipid nanoparticles into the body, one doesn't have entire control of what tissues will take up these particles and express genes. So the company, to get more selectivity for the targeted receptor, designed a very clever strategy to express this receptor selectively in immune cells. Now, to explain how this works, I have to tell you a little bit about the macrophage receptor, which is called the FC or FC gamma receptor, which consists of two different kinds of chains. One is the alpha chain, which normally would interact with antibodies or opsonized cells. And then this gamma chain, which is an intracellular signaling molecule, and it forms a heterodimer. Now, in this design strategy, the alpha chain is replaced by this now artificial alpha chain, which consists of this extracellular tumor single chain antibody. But it needs this gamma chain for full function. And in fact, if you express this designer alpha chain or even a natural alpha chain in a non-immune cell, it's unstable without the gamma chain and it becomes degraded. So non-immune cells that don't have also express the gamma chain do not support stable alpha chain expression. So the idea then is that the selectivity comes in from the natural biology that the immune cells, like these myeloid cells, would express the gamma chain and then heterodimerize with this introduced lipid nanoparticle gene, and you'd have a functional and stable receptor on the surface of these cells. So that's the idea, that you make these mRNA-loaded lipid nanoparticles, which Myeloid Therapeutics has done. It was tested in tail infection in animals. And then, first of all, to look at the selectivity, they collected different organ systems and measured the expression of this introduced gene, both on myeloid cells from these different tissues, as well as non-myeloid cells. And you can see that there's good expression in the myeloid cells and selective expression compared to other cells in those organs. And the first results in these mice models, now this is with the lipid nanoparticle delivery, look very promising. Here is an average data set for untreated versus these lipid nanoparticle treated mice with these synthetic receptors. And there's the data from all the individual mice. And now this is my final slide. Now, that last strategy is in the process of being prepared for an IND, and we're Myeloid Therapeutics is obviously very excited to have this progress now to clinical trials. So the overall message I want to tell you about is that these myeloid cells are of the innate immune system are a very powerful cell, I think, for treating cancer. They also work by many different mechanisms, including engulfment, which I showed you, but they also produce cytokines, which act as an inflammatory setting to attract more immune cells. They also activate T cells. So I think these cells could be a very exciting new mechanism for treating cancer. So with that, you know, I think this is a good example of how some basic science, as I started my talk, really understanding how cells work, how receptors work, how signaling systems work at a very basic level, which was done by Megan and Adam, kind of led to now a whole way to design synthetic cells. And that is the work of a very large team of individuals, very, very talented at this new company in Boston, Myeloid Therapeutics. So with that, thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much. Okay, so next, let's welcome Professor Xu Jinbo. Welcome.
Okay, thank you all for coming to my talk. It's my pleasure to come here to talk about my recent work. So today I'm going to talk about how we can use AI, artificial intelligence, to study proteins, especially to do protein design. Some of you may have already know that in the past few years, so AI did a great job in predicting the structure of a protein. So the protein structure prediction problem is well defined. And so here, suppose we have a protein amino acid sequence. We wanted to use computational methods to predict the 3D structure of this protein to predict the positions of atoms of this protein in the space. So this is the protein structure prediction problem. So this problem is very challenging before, but in the past few years, through the effort of the whole community, especially DeepMind, so now we can do structure prediction very well, in particular for a single protein chain. Now we can, using AI, to do the structure prediction very well. So this slide shows you the progress of protein structure prediction in the past 30 years. So this picture is drawn by the founder of the CASP, which is the critical assessment of structure prediction, Professor John Mould. So he drew this picture to show the progress of this field in the past 30 years. So in the left picture, you can see there are many curves. And so each basically each curve represents one contest. So you can see these curves can be grouped into three. So three groups of curves. So the bottom 12 curves represent the past 24 years of the progress. And the top four curves represent the achievement by AI. So you can see here, so AI did much better than the traditional methods. And so now we almost solved the problem. So yeah, now we can use an AI to do structural prediction. And so this changed the mindset of a molecular biologist. So before, molecular biologists do research, they study proteins based on only a sequence. But now we can use the predictive structure to study proteins. And so there are also some misunderstanding about the program AlphaFold2 developed by DeepMind. So, AlphaFold2 can do a very good job in predicting the structure of a single protein chain, but actually this is the only job that can be done by AlphaFold2, and there are also many other problems that cannot be addressed by AlphaFold2. For example, so AlphaFold2 is not very good at predict how two protein or multiple proteins they bind together. And in particular, AlphaFold2 is not very good in predicting antigen antibody binding. And also for some specific type, for one specific type of proteins, like orphan proteins, so AlphaFold2 is not very good at predicting the structure for an orphan protein. And then in particular, so AlphaFold2 cannot do, like say, protein design. And so you cannot use AlphaFold2 to design a protein. And you cannot use AlphaFold2 to, like say, to optimize a protein and to mutate a protein to achieve the desired function. And AlphaFold2 cannot predict the interaction between proteins and other molecules, like say, the small molecule and the DNA and RNA. So if you wanted to do the prediction, if you want to predict the interaction between proteins and the DNA RNAs, then you will need to use other software. So this is what cannot be done by AlphaFold2. So now in the following slides, I'm going to show you. So in order to do protein design, what we should do. So here I briefly introduce protein design. So by protein design, we mean we wanted to create proteins that doesn't exist in nature. So in particular, we wanted to find one or multiple amino acid sequences adopting a user-defined structure or and performing designed function. So this is a simple definition of a protein design. So the protein design is very different from protein structure prediction. So later I'm going to show you some examples, show you different scenarios for protein design. So protein design is still, although now AI is achieving, it's transforming protein design, it's doing some great work on protein design, but still, protein design is still challenging. So this is because sequence space is huge and it's discrete, extremely narrow with stable functions. So only a small portion of the sequence space can be folded into the stable structure conformation. And also, right now, predicting the function of given protein, so it's not totally resolved. So although we can use AI to predict the function of a protein, but actually, this problem is not 100% resolved. So this is a challenge of protein design. And the protein design has many applications. So here, let me show you one kind of application. So protein design proteins can be used for diagnosis and disease treatment and also disease prevention. So here, I show you three examples. So this is the work done by Professor David Baker at the University of Washington. So in the past few years, David Baker, especially for the COVID-19. So the Baker's lab, so they designed the proteins for the diagnosis of COVID-19 and also for the antiviral proteins. So designed some small proteins that can prevent the spike protein, the COVID-19 virus get into the human body. And also when a vaccine was approved in Korea, so for the COVID-19. So in addition to this for drug and also for the disease treatment and prevention, and we can also design proteins for other applications, like say for the industrial and also agriculture and also environment. So different from protein structure prediction. So the problem of protein structure prediction is well defined. So it's a mapping from amino acid sequence to structure. But for protein design, there are different scenarios. So we have different problems for protein design. For example, so sometimes we wanted to design a protein backbone that is adopting a specific shape. And sometimes we wanted to optimize the amino acid sequence that can fold into a specific protein shape. And sometimes we want to design a protein that can, a small protein that can bind a target or bind with a receptor. And sometimes we want to optimize the functional site of a protein. So there are different application scenarios for protein design. So based, so for this kind of different scenarios, then we need to develop a different AI algorithm to deal with them. So I'm going to show you some work done by my group in the past few years on protein design. So here I show you one example. Like I said, here we wanted to design a protein backbone. So we have developed an algorithm that can design a protein backbone for any size and also with different conformational complexity. Especially now we can by using AI we can design a protein backbone of with many amino acids. So before using traditional methods, usually we can only design small proteins with no more than say 100 amino acids. But now quite a few groups, including my group, so we can. We can design proteins of with more than 100 amino acids. We can even design a protein with 200 or 300 amino acids. And also the topology of the protein designed by our algorithm can also be very complex. So we, in addition to only alpha protein, we can also design alpha beta proteins using the AI method. And also we can, by using AI, we can design proteins which are more stable. So this kind of protein may have a similar functions as a protein in nature, but the desired protein is more stable, has lower energy, and can also perform the function in some extreme condition, for example, in high temperature. So this is another work done by my group. So here, in this slide, I show you some examples here. So three examples. So we have, so we design proteins which are similar structurally and functionally similar to protein in nature, but it's more stable. And so given a protein scaffold or a protein backbone, and so we can also use an AI to design the amino acid sequence that can fold into this specific protein backbone, for example. So this kind of method so can be used to, like say, to improve the stability of a specific protein, like to improve stability for enzymes and also antibodies, can also be used to improve the affinity between two proteins. So here we use some, so in this slide, the left picture shows the neural network architecture used by, developed by my group. So we use some kind of geometric deep learning method to do this. So the input of this network is a protein backbone and the output is a designed amino acid sequence. So to test our method, we also, check how well we can recover the native amino acid sequence of a protein in nature. And so the right table show you the nature protein sequence recovery rate. And so we compare our method with a few other methods, including both the deep learning method and also traditional methods. So the right table show you, so actually now we can do, we can recover the native sequence very well. So the success rate is more than 50%. And so by using this kind of AI model, and then we can also predict the effect of mutations on protein stability. So protein stability prediction or the it's a very important problem. But the challenge of this problem is that we don't have many, we don't have a lot of wet lab data to train an AI model. So we know, so usually to train an AI model, we will need a large amount of data, right? But here, actually, by using the AI model I just mentioned, so we do not need any wet lab data to train our AI model. So we can just use the AI model we developed to predict the mutation effect. And so here I show you the results. So one, so in this slide, there are two kinds of results. One is that the top table is one is results on one group of test data, and the bottom figure is the test results on another group of data. So because we don't have much wet lab data, so we don't use any of this wet lab data to train our model. So we just test our method on this wet lab data. So this both the picture and the table indicator. So yeah, by using our method, we can do the stability prediction very well. And now we can also use the AI, use this AI method to predict the double changes in the Gibbs free energy. So so we achieved very good results in predicting the delta G. This problem is also very challenging because we do not have much training data to train our AI model. So for this specific task, we only have very small training data set. So this training data set has only include only 200 proteins and is about 4,000 mutations. So given such a small training data, usually it's very hard to train a good model. But we developed an algorithm, so which managed to just use such a small training data, and but can achieve very good results. So we test our AI algorithm by comparing our predicted results with the experimental measures, and we calculate the correlation coefficient between our prediction and the experimental results. And we achieved a very good correlation coefficient. You can see as shown in this table. So the right column is the correlation coefficient between the prediction results and the experimental measure. And the left column of this table are just some methods, some methods. So our method can achieve the correlation coefficient achieved by our method is more than 60%, which is much higher than previous method, including previous deep learning method. And we also developed an AI model. So this model can design a protein, especially a small protein or an antibody that can bind with a specific target. So by using this algorithm, then we can design some therapeutic proteins. For example, so our algorithm can do two different, two correlated, but it's also different tasks. So first task is we can using this model to optimize, let's say to just to mutate an existing drug, which can to improve the affinity and the specificity of this drug. And in addition to improve existing protein drugs, we can also, from scratch, we can design a novel protein binder that can bind to this targeted protein. And so we can just, we don't need to use any existing library or any existing protein as a library. We can just design such a binder from scratch. And finally, so in order to verify, like say, if we designed protein binder can bind with the target very well, then we also need to we developed one AI algorithm that can bind, can predict the binding of two or three or multiple proteins. So we developed an AI-based protein-protein docking and a protein complex structure prediction algorithms. And also this problem is not totally resolved, but now we can do much better than before. So by using a new AI algorithm, so we can predict the protein-protein docking much better than previous deep learning methods. For the antibody design, we also developed one algorithm. So this AI algorithm can reconstruct the CDR region of antibody. By using this algorithm, then we can improve we can redesign the CDR region of antibody to improve the affinity between antibody and antigen. So here, this table shows you some results. So we compare with a couple of other AI methods. So yeah, we can achieve very good results in rebuilding the CDR region to redesign the CDR region. Okay, so here I just summarize my talk. So this is the take home message. So AI has revolutionized protein structure prediction, and it's also transforming protein design. So by using the AI method, now we can design proteins of different size and different conformations, and this designed proteins now is playing some important roles. And I believe in the coming few years, and so AI can help us to design more and more useful proteins. And so the design proteins have many different applications. In addition to drug design, we can also use protein design to design new biomaterials and also to improve environment. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Jinbo, for your wonderful speech. Next, let's connect with Professor Erwin. Yeah. Professor Nair, so now it's time for your speech. Welcome. We cannot hear you. Sorry. Yeah.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah, please.
Yes. Okay. So, well, my presentation will be relatively short since I'm not working on synthetic biology. What I want to convey is a kind of bivalent message. On the one hand, I'm very impressed by what a biological engineering can achieve, what we just heard about artificial intelligence can being able to predict protein structure, cell engineering to convert cells into weapons against cancer. So there are many real good progress in the field. However, when one talks about artificial life, I would also like to point out that implementing all the cellular signaling networks which are necessary for a synthetic cell to
excuse me, Professor Nair, could you please share your slides?
I did so.
We cannot see it.
Okay. Can you see me now?
We can see you, but cannot see it. Now. Okay, yeah.
Yeah, everything fine?
Yeah, fine. Yeah, great.
Yeah, okay. Great. So my message will be kind of bivalent. On the one hand, kind of admiration for what we can do now with our present knowledge on biological cells and biological processes. On the other hand, the daunting task of trying to create life from scratch, in particular, implementing the cellular networks involved in that. Let me do this from the standpoint of my research on signaling mechanisms, in particular ion channels over the last 50 years. So when we started work on ion channels in the 1970s, we expected to find ion channels in so-called electrically excitable cells, which are nerve cells, muscle cells, some neuroendocrine cells. And we didn't know more than about 5 to 10 different so-called cells and five or ten kinds of ion channels. Five to ten different types of ion channels is what we expected, you know. However, with the improvement of the technology to study these ion channels, it turned out that ion channels are not only present in electrically excitable cells, they are basically found in any cell type and subserve most different functions, such as, of course, regulating electrical excitability, regulating calcium channels, volume regulation, all the sensory transduction mechanisms are all mediated by ion channels. And these come in many different flavors. They may be permeable to sodium ions only, like in the nerve action potential, or potassium ions only for the downstroke of the action potential. Particularly, there are ion channels very specific for calcium ions, which more or less link the electrical excitability to the intracellular biochemistry. There are channels for chlorides, and there are unspecific channels being permeable to both sodium and potassium ions, and many other combinations. Channels may be activated by voltage, by neurotransmitters, by mechanical stress. That's a topic of last year's Nobel Prize, by odors, by heat, cold, and so on. You know, and today we know about 200 genes which code for ion channel proteins. So, presenting the channel ohm in the form of a evolutionary tree, you can see each endpoint here is a type of ion channels. You can see there are many, many more than the 5 or 10 channels that we expected to find in the 1970s. So what I want to stress is that when trying to replicate something like this, we have a moving target, a target which expands from day to day, so to speak. So just as another example here in the background, the well-known pathways, biochemical pathways map, which include hundreds, maybe up to thousands of different reactions, which are all controlled by signaling processes. So compared to this, the ion channel network is probably only a small part of the signaling cosmos, you know. And considering that ion channels are multimeric proteins with a high variety of subunit combinations and splice isoforms, the signaling network just represented by ion channels may be of similar size to what you see here in the background. Okay, so what's the prospect then? The one hand, the de novo assembly of genes for the very simplest organisms may be something which can be accomplished in the not too far future. Of course, present day technology works by copy and paste of modules of the genome, which allows us to achieve bacteria and cells with special functions, as we saw in the preceding contributions, you know. It's of course possible to redesign existing biological systems for new purposes, you know. And also it is quite feasible to grow organoids from stem cells for transplantation and repair. So these are highlights of synthetic biology. And I think they work because evolution has designed modules which need to be robust, otherwise life would have ended very soon. So, yeah, that's my message. The achievements are great, you know, but the goal of creating completely new synthetic life is probably a task which is not yet on the horizon. So thank you for the attention.
Okay, thank you very much. So next, let's connect with Professor Zheng Anping. Yeah.
Yeah, that's great. Okay, it's a great pleasure for me to talk about YUAN and air-based synthetic biology and bioengineering, biomanufacturing. So this is the outline of my talk. I will first give a very brief introduction to synthetic biology and YUAN use, and then go through two approaches and some case studies where I will end up with a perspective. We know we are facing several global challenges in the years to come, including energy, food, environmental, climate, and population. Systems biology and biomanufacturing will be essential tools to address some of these global challenges because they can really make or provide a lot of solutions and products in the areas of biomedical, agricultural, food, chemical, biomaterials, et cetera. By the end of this century, probably one third of all group manufacturing can be made by biomanufacturing. The question is how we can achieve this. Of course, we need to have very efficient cell factory or synthetic cells. It's the topic of this today's session. On the other side, we need also to have the right raw materials. So far, biomanufacturing is mainly based on sugar. The question is, is this sustainable? Can we really do the manufacturing, biomanufacturing such scale with sugar-based raw material? I don't think it will be the right solution. So in the future, I think we need really to have new carbon source, and this will be CO2 or C1 based. So to replace sugar with CO2 as carbon source is a huge task. I don't think I need to emphasize more the impact of CO2 use. Everyone knows we need to reduce the CO2 content, right, in the atmosphere. Now, nature has evolved many solutions, also microbes and plants to fix CO2. The issue is they're unfortunately not so fast or so efficient as we would like to have. So people have tried to design new or synthetic pathways to fix CO2 to produce chemicals. Here you see a comparison of different natural and designed pathways. We have several obstacles, either for the natural or the designed CO2 fixation pathways, because CO2 basically has no energy in terms of biosynthesis. We need to have, to put energy into it. So the energy demand is an issue. Also the product spectrum of natural and designed pathway is still very much limited. The pathway is probably still quite too long. We need to have a couple of enzymes and the pathway may interfere with the central metabolism, et cetera, et cetera. At the end of the day, the fixation rate or the productivity are basically too slow for technical application. People have tried to address some of these problems. One of the interesting pathway is so-called reductive glycine pathway. This is so far the most efficient C1 fixation pathways reported. I will come back to this pathway again. We are working also on this pathway for several years. Now I get to the second part of my presentation, approaches and case studies. So there are basically two approaches to capture and utilize CO2 biotechnologically. One is based on cell, so a starting point. This is so-called top-down approach. Another approach is bottom-up, making use of components like enzymes to do really synthetic cells from scratch or to have kind of minimum cell for biosynthesis. I will go through the first case, top-down approach. As I mentioned, CO2 for biosynthesis, it's actually a big challenge because it has the most oxidized form. It is the most oxidized form of biomolecules. The question is how we can put energy into it. There are several ways of doing it. One of the most efficient way probably is to use C1, a liquid C1 feedstock, like formate, methanol, or other electron carriers, which can be produced from water, from electricity. And with this energy-rich compound, then we can incorporate also CO2. Of course, then you can do synthetic biology. You can start with synthetic genome or genetic circuits, et cetera, but still here, we are actually on early development. I want to share with you some of our experience in producing a platform chemical, 1,3-propanediol. This is a very, very nice compound with huge market. It has been now also biotechnologically produced. It is a really, industrial process. The question is, we are now using still sugar and, I show you this pathway. The present production process is based on sugar or glycerol. The question is, can we produce PTO from CO2 or methanol, this kind of C1 compounds? Theoretically, and it is possible in the lab. Actually, we have also demonstrated several new pathways. For example, from CO2, from methanol, we can get 1,3-propanediol. We can also starting from CO2 and ethanol. Because of time, I wouldn't get into much detail of these pathways. Instead of that, I want to mention another important aspect in developing synthetic cells for biomanufacturing, because in most cases, we have probably just proof concept in the lab, just get a few milligram per liter. It's still far away from industrial application. And also the synthetic cells are mostly not so stable, not robust enough. So there are a lot of issues you have to address. One of the efficient methods is to do laboratory adapted evolution and also integrated bioprocess development. Here you see one screen to show how we move from designed or re-engineered cells for the production of 1,3-propanediol. At the beginning, it works quite well with pure glycerol, for example, but if you use the technical raw material, crude glycerol, it didn't work at all. And here we use kind of automated laboratory evolution system to improve the performance to really have very robust strain, which can be even operated under steroid conditions. If you do fermentation, the sterilization and keep the system sterile consumes a lot of energy. So this is a really huge saving in the operation costs. Another issue here is integrated production for biosynthesis. Normally, you are not just produce one compound. You quite often have also so-called co-production of waste products. And here, in this case, we turned also the so-called waste products into valuable products, that is the organic esters. And we can even recover also the gases from the effluent gas. Here's in German, in Chinese, but the message is here, we need to have real system level solution, especially for technical application. And this is an example. In terms of C1 use, C1 based manufacturing, another important development is to use green electricity to electrify the biosynthesis. This is also an area which has achieved a lot of attention. We have also worked for several years intensively. Here we need to have fundamental work in the engineering, but also in the synthetic biology. In the synthetic biology, of course, new pathways, et cetera, as I showed you before for the 1,3-propanediol. On the other side, we need to have new bioelectrochemical systems or reactors and then put them together. And this is what we have done or demonstrated in the 1,3-propanediol process. Here, I show you on the left-hand side, a so-called all-in-one electrobioreactor. This was developed in our lab. Basically, it's kind of in situ water electrolysis. We get oxygen and hydrogen. And with that, you can, of course, also convert CO2 into CO or other things. You can also use the hydrogen to drive the biosynthesis. Here we use the hydrogen to drive the biosynthesis. You can see in this table, we could increase the production of 1,3-propanediol by more than 60%. And the byproducts, beauty rate, even by more than 150%. So this is an example to show how to really have so-called biomanufacturing at large industrial scale. This is an industrial process we are setting up at quite large scale. This was a case for the top-down approach with cells. I'm going to share with you some of our experience with enzymes to make use of CO2 for biosynthesis. I mentioned the reductive glycine pathway, the most efficient C1 fixation pathway. This is very nice. You can use CO2 formate and then get to glycine, the so-called C2 amino acid. From there, you can get to serine and pyruvate C3. And from C3, you can get to many useful compounds. The problem is this so-called C1 to C3 pathway is embedded in a very complicated metabolic network. So it is very difficult or challenge to plug in such pathway into a synthetic cell or into a new cell. Here, you need to really handle the interactions of different parts. So to get rid of these interactions, to make the storage more controllable or the more engineerable way, we need to have kind of out-of-box thinking. Namely, probably use enzyme cascades as a minimum synthetic cell. This is my approach, which shows also great potential. In this case, we demonstrated with the reductive glycine pathway to capture CO2. This is a re-engineered reductive glycine pathway. We have implemented several new enzymes. The basic idea is you can incorporate CO2 through methanol, or you can also incorporate CO2 directly. You can incorporate CO2 again. Here, the most important part, the central part, is so-called H protein system, which has a very nice or interesting structure with so-called swinging arm, the lipoamide arm, which will move among three different enzymes and then catch CO2 and catch ammonia. So here you see the structure of this swinging arm. This is normally protected in the cavity of the so-called edge protein. If it's protected, so the activity is low. So the key issue is how to get it released. And here we have done then some fundamental study from the structure point of view, from dynamic point of view, try to really short the release time. And as you can see here on the right hand side, we can reduce the release time significantly, and in such a way also increase the productivity or the reaction activity quite significantly. With that in the hand, we can then do more. Here is one example I want to share with you. We tried to mimic Miller's experiment, basically to produce amino acids from air, from atmosphere. This is some of the result. We used this. We re-engineered glycine cleavage system. Try to get to the mouse. To reuse gaseous CO2. Many reports in the literature normally use liquid CO2. Carbonate, bicarbonate. Here we use directly CO2, gaseous CO2. And as you can see here, we generated glycine directly from CO2. Also, of course, I should to mention here, we add some methanol, and here serine production and pyruvate. Basically, we realize from C1 carbon to C2 carbon and to C3 carbon. There's comparison of different systems, different pathways. As I mentioned before, one of the key issues is the energy requirement. Most of pathways, you have to put ATP and DH or NADPH as reducing power, our system doesn't need any ATP and NADPH. Actually, we use a kind of chemically driven force. I don't have time to talk about the detail. We are actually patenting the process. Here, the reaction steps, we have the minimum reaction step 4 in other well-known pathways. Sometimes even 17 enzymes were required. Importantly also, our system's much robust. If you look also the fixation rate, we achieved about 3-5 times more than reported so far. So with this, we are on the way to generate or to establish a kind of air-based synthetical biology. The long-term goal is to use air as the raw material to generate some of the key components or common intermediates. From this common intermediates, then we produce C2, C3, and CX carbons. That means diverse final products. We try to develop this system actually according to a way established universal structure of manufacturing. Probably you have heard the so-called bow tie structure. This was actually we discovered this in the biological in the metabolic network 20 years ago. Later on, John Doyle from Caltech extended in this concept into a universal structure. He claims for all the manufacturing processes, all so complex network. Basically, we can narrow down to a bow tie structure, as you see here for building a house, right? You get the doors and windows standardized, and the raw material is the wood, and it is produced, distributed in a distributed way. Actually, we are establishing a kind of new biotechnology system according to this universal law. And this is actually quite different from the present practice. Okay, we use sugar, and each process has its own characteristic. Basically, each process is different. We hope we can have a more general platform here. So from the perspective of synthetic biology, what we need to do is we need to establish the so-called central synthetic unit to get this common intermediates or key intermediates. We need to design the input module, use C1 component or ideally the air, and this is as input through this central synthetic unit. Then we get kind of output module, which is of course designed depending on the need of the product you want to have. And this is a kind of perspective of synthetic biology from the biomanufacturing point of view, what we are trying to do here. Having said that, I'd like then to thank people who have contributed to different parts of the work I presented. I was for many, many years in Germany, 30 years, more than 35 years in Germany, Hamburg, last station, and I moved to Westlake this year. I spent all some time as as a kind of part-time PI at the Beijing University of Chemical Engineering, Chemical Technology. I would like to thank you for your attention and end up with this slide. I would like to say the future belongs to the sky. Thank you very much.
So we will skip the tea break because we have exceeded the time limit. If you want to have a tea break, you can go out to get some refreshments. Okay, let's get started.
So welcome back to the fifth WLA forum and WLA laboratory series toward the synthetic cells. Let's connect Professor Stephen Hale.
Okay, thank you for having me in this session. Now in this session, which is about discussing the options of having a synthetic cell in the end, it's very clear that you need a very, very high spatial resolution in order to see what's in the cell and where the molecules are located, And of course, you want to know with very high spatial temporal resolution where the molecules are actually going. And this is why I'm going to talk about these two very, very important topics. I'm going to show you the latest progress in this field. Now, when it comes to finding out the position of a molecule with high spatial temporal resolution, people typically do a so-called, say, classical camera-based localization, which is actually shown on this slide. And this localization works by having an epifluorescent microscope that illuminates the focal plane at once, and the task is to find out the position of a fluorescent molecule that is usually attached to a biomolecule of interest. And this works by projecting the fluorescence of that fluorescent molecule onto a camera. Now, since the camera consists of many pixels, what the camera will actually produce is an image of the diffraction blob of the fluorescent light. And localization is then accomplished by calculating the centroid of this diffraction blob. And then the centroid of this diffraction blob, which is shown in here, is then directly telling us where the molecule is in the focal plane, because the position of the centroid of the fluorescence blob on the camera is tightly connected with the position of the molecule in the sample by simple geometrical optics. Now, the precision with which we can find out the position of the molecule in the sample scales inversely with the square root of the number of photons that are detected on the camera. Meaning that if we detect, 100 photons, of course, we get a certain precision. If we detect 10,000 photons, for example, we are more precise by a factor of 10. Now, this concept clearly relies on the maximization of the number of detections. And this is actually a part of the problem here, because as you will appreciate, if you need many photons, of course, the method of localizing in this way is inherently slow, because you have to wait for getting a high number of detected photons. So that makes the method slow. Not only that, usually fluorescent molecules tend to bleach, they tend to blink, and then of course you have only limited precision that you can achieve. Besides, there's another problem. Fluorescent molecules are dipole emitters, and if they are kind of tilted, of course, with respect to the focal plane, then the whole pattern shifts to the side. And all these factors contribute to the problem that with normal localization, so this camera-based localization, it's hard to get a precision that is better than about 10 nanometers. And this also accounts for the fact that standard palm storm super resolution images have great difficulties getting a spatial resolution that is better than that. So I decided that we are not going to do it this way. And that's why I came up with an idea that localizes molecules in a totally different way. And I'm explaining to you now how it works. It's called MinFlux. And the basic idea behind MinFlux is not to have a wide field illumination as is usually done in normal localization. Rather, we have a beam of light that is converted by simple optics into a donut. Why a donut? A donut beam, of course, is capable of determining a coordinate in a sample plane with very, very high precision. Why? The center of the donut, which is produced by destructive interference of light, is very, very precisely defined. Also because the many photons of the donut here, a laser produces, say, a high number of photons, can very precisely define here the center of this, say, light pattern in the sample plane. And then, of course, the localization boils down to finding the position, the unknown position of the molecule with respect to the known position of the donut. Why is the position of the donut always known? It's very clear because we determine actually the position of the donut by means of a beam deflector. We have here a beam deflector that can be a Galvo scanner or another type of beam deflector that can shift the donut around. And so we always know where the donut is. The only thing we have to find out where the molecule is located with respect to the known position of the donor. And that can be easily found out just by measuring the fluorescence that is produced when the donor scans over the molecule. Keep in mind, the donut here is a donut that excites molecules. And here's the resulting fluorescence. This resulting fluorescence now is, of course, minimal when the donut zero crosses the molecule. And then we know the position of the molecule. It must be the position where the position of the donut where the fluorescence is minimum. Now, if you look into this localization scheme, what becomes instantly apparent is that the precision sigma with which we can localize the position of the molecule is proportional to this average distance between the molecule and the donut zero, this distance L. And this distance L can, of course, be reduced because once I know roughly where the molecule is, I can bring the donut as close as possible to the molecule. And then, of course, I can inherently increase the precision N. So I have a handle on increasing the precision, which I don't have if I do normal localization with a camera. Therefore, if you want to get a precision of 2 nanometers with this concept of min flux, it's perfectly enough to have 30 photons, for example. So 30 photons, which are very quickly detected, give you already a precision of 2 nanometers. By comparison, if you want to get this precision with a camera, if you get it at all, usually you don't get it. It would require about 10,000 photons. And that tells you that this localization, this min flux localization is very efficient and very fast. So what we do with this concept is we increase the precision and the speed of localization. And the physics reason why this is possible is that we put the burden of requiring many photons for localization on the laser beam. So far, with normal localization, the burden of requiring many photons is put on the fluorescence emissions. You need many fluorescence photons to find the position. But now, the burden of requiring many photons is put on the illumination side. And that's why we can save many, many, many detection photons and get a very, very high spatial precision. Now, it's very obvious that this new concept lends itself to tracking biomolecule movements with a precision and speed that has not been seen so far. And having had Ron VALE on the panel, actually, I decided to talk about kinesin 1, which he co-discovered many, many years back and had fundamental contributions to. And so I'm going to show you how this localization concept of min flux now really helps us understand very, very basic, phenomena regarding the processing of kinesin 1 on microtubules. Now, in order to get a high spatial resolution, what people did so far when they investigated kinesin, they attach big beads. But if you attach very big beads that are, say 20, 100 times bigger than the kinesin itself, of course, you are very prone to inducing artifacts and you have all kinds of problems. So we can get the same spatial resolution without the beads just by attaching a tiny floor for either to the stalk of the kinesin or to one of the heads and so on. And we can watch it with the same precision as other people do it with beads and see actually what is going on and learn something about the mechanistics of kinesin 1 movement. Now, most of you will know how kinesin works. So it works in a hand-over-hand fashion. And now what is labeled here is actually the stalk, so the coil-coil domain. And then we should be able to see the 8 nanometer steps like this. And indeed, we do see them with a very high precision. So the sigma here is 1.72 nanometers. Now, this precision actually was achieved a couple of years back by Ron VALE and Paul Selvin. However, with a temporal resolution of the order of 330 milliseconds. But now we get the same resolution, spatial resolution within 5 milliseconds. So we are much, much faster, meaning we can observe things that they couldn't observe at that time with single flow for example, substeps. As a matter of fact, we can see substeps, and this is shown in here, 4 nanometer substeps, you see 8 nanometer steps, 6 nanometer steps, because we are so precise. We see steps that usually are not seen, like 6 nanometer, you wouldn't anticipate that. The reason why we can see it is that the precision that we get, even at a high speed, is below 1 nanometer. And so this is actually a distribution of steps that are actually measured. So we see 4 nanometer steps, 8 nanometer, 6, and so on. And this can be used, of course, to find out key details of how kinesine works on the microtubules. Now, I'm not going to go through all the things that we have found by studying kinesine. I just want to give you one example, which I think is quite nice. So we measured actually how the head twists during the stepping. So, and this can be done by labeling, for example, the end of this head of kinesine 1 with a flow of 4, and then watch the steps. So here the steps are measured, and then we found that it turns like this. And how do we know that it turns like this? Well, we observed the movement of this flow of 4 while the flow of 4 is attached to the rear end, and then we attached the flow of 4 to the front end of the head, and then measure the steps again. And you see now that the steps look different. This is shown in here. And this has allowed us to detect actually this twist of the head during the stepping. You need the spatial resolution, need the precision, and you need the temporal resolution in order to see this. Otherwise you don't see it. Moreover, this is actually showing actually how this head's processed in here. And you can see a bias to the right. So we also observe that while this processing takes place, the head has a bias in the rightward direction when it processes to the plus end of the microtubule. This is just to show you that you can find out things due to the fact that the spatial temporal resolution is fundamentally increased over this normal, say, camera-based localization. And again, you get a spatial temporal resolution that is about of the order of those that you need get with beats, but you don't need beats here, and there is little or no disturbance. So finally, I would like to show that, of course, we have also made big progress when it comes to STET microscopy. Now, many of you will know how STET microscopy works. Now, STET is a scanning method which has a beam for exciting molecules for turning the fluorescence on, but it also uses a beam for turning the fluorescent molecules off, the STET beam. And that STET beam is shaped into a donut. And because this STET beam has the role of turning fluorescence off, only the fluorescent molecules that happen to be located within this very small region here are in the end capable of producing a signal. So we confine the effective excitation of the fluorophore to very small dimensions. Now, this method of STET microscopy, as it turns out, is very, very effective when you want to localize molecules, because you can come up now, or we came up with a way of localizing molecules that's very similar to MinFlux. And it works like this. So what we do actually is we move those beams jointly around such that the region of, say, fluorescence excitation forms a donut. And in that case, the localization precision can be increased even down to the angstrom range. So we get a sigma that really goes down to about 3 angstrom for about 10,000 photons, of course, with about 1,000 photons, you get 5 angstrom. So these are world record localization precisions at room temperature of fluorophores. So you don't get that with a camera, of course, and with no other method to my knowledge. And because of that, under the provision, of course, that we turn individual molecules on and off stochastically, the combination of, say, the switching of individual molecules with this high localization precision gives a spatial resolution that is extremely high, basically, say, at the molecular scale. And I'm going to show you now data from nuclear pore complex. Actually it's a protocol NUP96, which is very often used as a reference for finding out how good the resolution is. And just 81 recordings have allowed us to produce this average image. So these are the this nuclear pore has an 8-fold symmetry, and these are the individual proteins here, NUP96. But we don't see the proteins, we see actually the fluorophores on the proteins. Now, since the localization is so precise, it makes perfect sense to compare it with cryo-EM data. And that's what we did. So we took cryo-EM data that was recently published by Martin Beck's group, and surprise, surprise, it perfectly fits. Now, and this is very interesting because, you know, structure biology and fluorescence microscopy now shake hands, literally. You can really see that in the end, both data are actually nicely fit together. So it shows that fluorescence microscopy is now increasingly starting to enter the realm of structure biology, where the two methods actually nicely complement each other. And this method, MINSTAT, as we call it, now provides record localization precision in imaging, and it certainly will play an important role in the future. So to sum up, MINFLUX and MINSTAT are two new methods that provide the highest spatial resolution in fluorescence microscopy so far, of the order of a nanometer, two or three, some true molecular scale spatial resolution. And a very important outcome in my view is that we get a record spatial temporal resolution. So if you want to see changes of biomolecules with a very high precision in the shortest possible period of time, so one nanometer change within a millisecond, this is now possible. And it's not the end of the development, because it's still, there's still room for improvement by making the fluorophores brighter and so on. And this is very exciting. So why is it exciting? If you had asked me maybe 8-9 years ago, or even 6 years ago, whether it would be possible to see nanometer changes within a millisecond in a cell, I would have said, I don't know, maybe the physics is not there. But what we know now, as a result of our investigations of the development of MINFLUX and MINSTAT, we know now that physics permits studying the dynamics of biomolecules at the nanometer scale in living cells. So there is a bright future for quantifying biomolecules at their own scale, nanometer scale, and at a relevant time scale of milliseconds or even sub-milliseconds. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. So now let's welcome Professor Shao Yangyang coming to the stage to deliver her speech. Welcome.
Thank you for the introduction, Professor Fan. And I'm glad to be here. Today, I'm going to talk about synthetic biology, about the creation and the new functional research of the artificial eukaryotic chromosome. So if we talk about biology, it's really about understanding the living organisms. And since the discovery of double helix structure of DNA, more and more scientists thought it was a great and simple way to understand the organisms from the molecular level. And the core of molecular biology describes the process in which DNA is transcribed into RNA, which is then translated into protein. And the protein catalyzes the production of various metabolites. And since 1990s, the advances in genomics and lately transcriptomics, proteomics, and metabolomics triggered a revolution in the discovery-based research and the systems biology to facilitate understanding even the most complex biological systems using a multi-omics way approach. And we call this is a reading stage, and with a decreased cost of DNA synthesis and sequencing, we come into a writing stage. And synthetic biology has grown rapidly since 2000, and it's about designing and constructing novel biological parts, devices and modules, or redesigning the natural biological systems. And one of its major goals is the creation of artificial life. But could the challenge be used, or could a synthesized cell be used to answer some basic but major questions in nature? For example, my PhD supervisor noticed a very interesting phenomenon and said this is the life tree. And he found that the chromosome number of eukaryotes is highly variable. For example, in plant kingdoms, the Arabidopsis have 10 chromosomes, while this kind of fern have more than 100, and this kind of butterfly itis blue have more than 400. In mammals, the Indian muntjac have 7 chromosomes, while human beings have 46. So the question is,
could we pack all the genome into one single chromosome and perform normal cellular functions? And we have heard the Saccharomyces cerevisiae several times from the previous report. So it's really a popular eukaryotic unicellular model organism. And it's a great way to address such address the question. So in nature, chromosomes sometimes fuse and evolve into novel karyotypes. For example, our relatives, the great apes, have 24 chromosome pairs, while we human beings have 23. It is speculated that our joint chromosome 2 is a product of fusion of two short chromosomes of the apes. So based on this, we developed an efficient chromosome fusion method, and by which we can pack the genome into a one single chromosome, one chromosome. And we set five criteria to follow. And the general principle is chromosome fusion should not affect cell growth. And there are many details to consider. And we had developed an efficient method for chromosome fusion. And in each round of chromosome fusion, we deleted two telomeres and one centromere to guarantee the novel chromosome can function correctly. And there are many hotspots near telomeres. So we deleted many telomeres associated repetitive sequences and retain one copy of each. As to the order of chromosome fusions, it was randomly selected, and we put the single chromosome roughly in the middle. As we can see, the whole genome of natural yeast are well organized on 16 chromosomes, and the two chromosomes were fused at a time. Two telomeres and one centromere, and the telomere-associated repetitive sequences can be deleted simultaneously. As to the chromosome pairs, the chromosome pairs were divided according to the disappearance of natural chromosomes or appearance of the novel chromosomes were easily to be distinguished in size by pulse field Gale electrophoresis. And thanks to Cas9, the Cas9 facilitated chromosome fusion method is really efficient. And this process is very smooth. And we try to retain the point centromere from a smaller chromosome or from a larger chromosome. They all worked. And after 50 rounds of chromosome fusion, we are succeeded to pack the whole genome into one giant chromosome. As you can see, more and more natural, more and more chromosomes are fused. And finally, we have succeeded in packing the whole genome into a single giant chromosome. And the artificial body has the same cell shape and cell size comparing to the natural budding yeast. As we can see, this picture shows the signals of telomeres with more and more telomeres deletion and the chromosome fusion. And the signals reduced to one or two. And the 3D conformation of chromosome changed drastically, but the artificial single chromosome yeast has nearly identical transcriptome and comparable phenome as a wild type. It can go functional meiosis, but with reduced sporulation efficiency and spore viability, which indicates that eukaryotes containing specific number of chromosomes do have some advantages. And Professor Gianni Litti commented these engineering yeast strain constitute powerful resources for study fundamental concepts in chromosome biology. And lately, we were wondering, as we know, the shape of chromosome of prokaryotes are usually circular, while the shape of chromosome of a eukaryotic cell is eurolinear. Can these natural limits be broken? And we, by deleting the, eh, sorry,
by deleting the last centromere, last telomeres of the single chromosome SY14, we are succeeded in constructing the single circular chromosome East SY15, but the cells displays many disadvantages such as abnormal cell morphology, reduced growth, and more sensitive to genotoxins, and it is unable to produce viable spores while meiosis. But it has one advantage. Even without telomerase, it is still an immortal cell. We made some effort to construct the version 2 single chromosome East. We got the mutants with increased sporulation efficiency, increased growth rate, and increased genotoxin resistance. And by exploring the mechanism, we hoped to provide some insight or hope to the abnormal chromosome diseases, such as the ring chromosome syndromes. And let's get to my last point. As we know, telomeres are at the end of the chromosome, like the tip of shoelace to protect our chromosome. As cell divides, telomeres get shorter, and when it is totally broken, it will send a signal to the cell, you are died. And we can say the longer your telomeres, the better off you are. So what if we replace the typical eukaryotic telomeres with primitive telomeres of fixed length, such as this kind of hairpin telomeres of phage or bacteria. And we succeeded in doing so. And the cell, the artificial cell shows reduced growth, but it evolved very quickly. And so by exploring the related mechanism, we think it will be a very amazing story about how the yeast adapt to such kind of primitive telomeres. And they are capable to finish the about works, and thank our collaborators, thank fundings. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much. Okay, so next let's welcome our final keynote speaker, Professor Yuan Yingjin. I think he will, he recorded a video for us, right?
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Yingjin Yuan from Frontier Science Center for Synthetic Biology, Tianjin University. I would like to thank the organizer for the invitation opportunity to share with you about the synthetic yeast and its applications, which I have been working on for years. Synthetic biology is a field of research in which the main objective is to create fully operational biological systems from the smallest constituent parts. According to the Encyclopedia Britannica, the logic that scientists follow is from discovery to synthesis. From small life molecules such as urine to polypeptides such as insulin. Our current challenge is from the discovery of a double helix structure of DNA to synthesis of designer genome. Rolling up is the most important features of a successful synthetic genome. This slide shows representative works on synthesis and the minimization of mycoplasma microgenome, record E. coli genome, and synthetic yeast genome. Prebiotic genome are typically circular with a relatively simple structure, while almost all natural urological chromosomes are linear and flanked by telomeres, carrying more information and featured a more complex structure. We selected the yeast genome as a research target, as it is one of the most popular model organisms. It is the first biological genome that has been completely sequenced and systematically analyzed. Another reason for us is that yeast as a microbial cell factory can also be used to produce medicine, fuel, and other chemicals. So we aim to de novo design and construct the eukaryotic yeast genome to test the effect of many gene changes to provide a trigger for direct genome evolution. There are three principles to design the synthetic yeast genome. Firstly, the growth phenotype should remain as the same as the wild type. Therefore, we keep the gene orders and the non-coding regions unchanged. Secondly, the genome stability should be increased by deletion of transposons and the relocation of tRNA. Thirdly, the genetic flexibility should be increased by systematically introduced blocking synthesis to facilitate the future study, which I will introduce later. We designed synthetic yeast chromosomes 5 and 10 according to the above three principles. On the basis of complete nucleotide sequence of native chromosomes, the length of SYN5 and SYN10 are 7.08% and 5.13% shorter than the native ones, respectively. 176 and 245 loss P synthesized are respectively added into the two synthetic chromosomes. Basically, we changed everything that can be changed and keep the part that is the important or unknown. Then, computer programs are generally used to split the designer genomic sequences into numerous oligos. Each oligo in lots of dozens of bases was then chemically synthesized out of source and assembled following the order from oligo to short DNA segment called building block, then to medium DNA segment called miniature, and eventually to long DNA segment called marketer. Finally, the wild type chromosomes 5 was replaced by SYN5 in 17 steps incorporation, and the Euro 3 and the Euro 2 were used as the selective markers alternatively. Our SYN5 building blocks and mini trunks were built and the sequence verified by students of the Build a Genome China course held by Tianjin University. During the whole construction process, the main obstacles that bother us were that bugs occurred during the genome building. This included lethal growth defects, respiration defects, and the carbon source of glycerol and ethanol. Similarly, bugs also occurred in Winter's group on Sincere. It is said, build a genome is a debugging process from the beginning. Here, I present a case study when we incorporate mitochondria C. SYN5 strains with mitochondria C exhibited severe growth defect. To generate a robust SYN5 strain, we first located the bug into mitochondria C and checked all the elements that were deleted or relocated, including TI gene and other gene. However, none of them were essential. So that gave us no choice but to locate the bug by mapping the whole synthetic DNA sequence. Several strategies are applied, including reconstruction of the SYN5 strain with different synthetic DNA segments, backcross of synthetic strains with wild-type strain, and the intercross of robust semi-synthetic strains with semi-synthetic strains exerting defect. Hundreds of colonies with diverse chromosomes were generated, which were characterized on both rich and selective media, one by one. Then, genotype identifications were performed by using PCR tags for both robust and defective strains to localize genomic bugs. By carefully analyzing an aligning PCR tag result, we found that defective colonies exhibited synthetic PCR tag applicants of 50 to 54 and 57. Therefore, we inferred that bugs were located at these genomic regions. According to IC 2.0 principles, key elements are deleted and tRNA genes are located to our neural chromosomes. However, while a K1 element and a tRNA gene of IMT4 were deleted, the gene of YEL27W was relocated and partially deleted. Therefore, the synthetic strains inhibit several growth defects. We updated the SYN5 design and fixed the bug by repairing the deleted YEL120W and updated the strain with a new version inhibit a biotype fittings. In total, more than 9 months was spent to fix this bug and generate a robust strain with a whole SYN5. So, a bugging matching strategy called pooled PCR tag mapping.
The chemical nature of biological phenotypic defense is genomic base sequence mismatch. Previous defect localization methods were used synthetic sequences for stepwise incorporation to replace natural sequences, which is time-consuming and laborious. The POPM method exploits the patchwork structure of synthetic and wild-type sequences observed in target regions of the majority of putative synthetic DNA integrants. After first phenotyping all integrants under selective conditions, such as high temperature and growth on a non-fermentable carbon source, each clone is then binned into one of two pools, normal fitness or a specific growth defect. PCR tag analysis with both synthetic and wild-type primer pairs, carried out with genomic DNA extracted from the two pools of clones, can be used to identify regions of synthetic DNA missing from the normal fitness pool and, analogously, sections of wild-type DNA absent from the specific growth defect pool.
Next, I will tell a story for repairing. Perfect match of an assembling sequence to a specific designer sequence is crucial to verify design principle in genome analysis. In this process, we create an initial isolate of C5 to perfectly match the designer sequence using integrity co-transformation and CRISPR-Cas9-mediated editing, as well as combine the two approach. In some cases, multiplex variants were corrected simultaneously. In total, the corrected base pair are 3,333 BP in SYNC file. The traditional HR-based gene replacement method was firstly applied to correct variations on SYNC file. A variation was firstly replaced by a selective marker, and then the selective marker was replaced by a donor DNA with a corrected sequence. This method required two steps of homogeneous recombination and selection. Arrhenius is laborious. Then a CRISPR-Cas9 mediated one-step method was developed. In this method, a DSP at the target gene was generated by CRISPR-Cas9. Subsequently, SNAs and indels were eliminated by HR of donor DNAs at the DSP. However, CRISPR-Cas9 mediated one-step method rely on the presence of MGJ sequence and therefore is not applicable to the entire synthetic yeast genome. Other problems of this method including variable efficiency and off-target cleavage. Therefore, a dual labeling correction strategy was developed to completely repair the remaining errors on SYNC file. A double selective cassette containing both an antibiotic gene and an atrophy gene was first incorporated adjacent to a specific target. Minimize false positive rate by doubling by double selection. Meanwhile, a process spacer and a palm set were also designed in the selective cassette. The process sponsor was then cut by Cas9 to increase the HR efficiency, and a pool of donor DNAs carrying multiple SN base and indels were co-transformed for multiplex corrections. The isolated colony with the most correction events was subject to the next round of correction. After 24 runs, all SN base and indels involving 3,333 base pairs on SYNC file were corrected, resulting SYNC file that was perfectly matching the designer sequence. This SYNC file strength was as robust as a wild-type strain. Synthesizing yeast genome needs worldwide efforts. Kinney University is responsible for chemically synthesized chromosome 5 and chromosome 10. Two yeast artificial chromosomes were both successfully synthesized by us. Furthermore, we synthesized the 17th artificial chromosome of yeast for data storage. This video shows how the 17th chromosome of yeast works.
Each CD, we encoded 6 pieces of dead DNA sequences. These sequences were combined with ours and YAC vector to form a circular DNA. This large encoded DNA achieved a very high logical and physical density. The DNA library was prepared with the extracted circular DNA within 20 minutes and then loaded to a nanopore flow seal. After pre-warming, the sequencing process started and raw reads were generated. Once the FASTQ file with 2000 noisy reads was generated, we can recover the original files. Just wait for about 40 seconds. Pictures and video clip in the large DNA appeared on a typical laptop.
Since the head carrying chromosome is a completely external DNA designed independent of DNA sequencing in nature, so we are very interested in the following issues. Firstly, is the diet carrying chromosome a naked DNA? Does it form a chromatin structure? We found that the chromatin acceptability of diet carrying DNA was significantly lower than that of mitochondrial DNA, which is naked DNA without histones. This suggested that diet carrying DNA is not naked DNA and wrapped around histone. Moreover, the chromatin accessibility of the data carrying DNA was distinctly higher than that of wild-type yeast DNA, demonstrating that the data carrying chromosomes was more accessible than the wild-type yeast chromosome. In addition, we found that there are obvious chief sequence peak in data carrying chromosome. This result indicated that data carrying chromosomes forms high accessible chromatin with active histone modifications. We then wonder how does the three-dimensional structure of data carrying chromosome organized. High-C data shown that data carrying chromosome is a circular chromosome in DE. The interaction heat map shown that the central mirror of data carrying chromosome was strongly interacting with the yeast chromosome central mirror. And the data carrying chromosomes and the yeast chromosome jointly form rub structures. Furthermore, we wonder whether the diet-carrying chromosomes was transcribed or translated and produced any new RNA or new polypeptide. Indeed, the diet-carrying chromosomes showed highly pervasive transcriptions. Next, we found 488 de novo isoforms. The average length of the isoform in the diet-carrying chromosomes was 3.6 kilobases, which was longer than the wild-type yeast isoform. However, we did not find any protein or peptide detected by RC mass spectrum. This indicated that data carrying chromosomes produce a lot of non-coding RNAs. Yes, it is the key proof of concept of these 17th yeast chromosomes. It can be applicable. This is what we wanted to show. Cultural heritage is suffering from inevitable and irreversible nature aging. For example, after only 100 years, a mural on the right in here or in cave 61 of Mongol cave has faded from its original spend. Long-term preservation is urgent. The practical value of DNA data storage in the preservation of cultural heritage. We chosen 10 amazing Dunhuang murals and transcoded them into actual DNA sequences for long-term storage. The murals include Chinese history stories and Buddha statues. The 10 Dunhuang invention were transcoded into 210,000 shortened DNA fragments with a length of 200 NT. Actual DNA molecules were obtained by chip-based DNA synthesis. To simulate the long-term natural degradation of DNA, the aging of DNA samples were accelerated at 70 degrees. Remarkably, the original death can be decoded even with a sample that has been treated for 70 days. This is only possible with the development of a new method to handle the massive DNA breaks caused by the degradation. Traditional algorithms cannot handle breaks and rearrangement. And scientists avoid this problem by discarding with breaks and enriches high-quality sequencing rates. But when facing long-term data storage, this is not an acceptable approach anymore. We built a de novo gene reconstruction algorithm based on Dublin graph. The algorithm includes two major steps. First, we construct a Dublin graph and simplify it by removing the lower coverage nodes in the graph. Then we reconstruct the right path greedy path search and the path selection. The path selection is achieved by the embedded error control code in each gene stream. As you can see, after treatment at 70 degrees for 70 days, 90% of DNA strain have been broken into very small pieces. Yet still, we were able to successfully recover the 10 Luan neural imaging accurately. It is worth mentioning that the treatment was similarly equivalent to 1,000 years at room temperature or 20,000 years at 9.4 degrees. Encyclopedia Britannica also states that synthetic biology is not with its risk. Conduct for life scientists in 2016. It consists of 10 guideline principles and norms. It called for a stronger biosecurity awareness among researchers and the responsible bioscience research from such perspective as the responsibilities of researchers, respondents' dissemination, public engagement in science and technology, and international collaboration. In 2021, it was then developed collaboratively by Tianjin University and Johns Hopkins University with inputs from scientists over 20 countries. WHO has recently issued the Global Guidance Framework for the Responsible Use of Life Sciences. It stated that the Tianjin Biosecurity Guidelines for Code of Conduct for Scientists are higher-level principles. I would like to thank collaborators and the group of members for their contribution, and thanks National Nature Science Foundation of China, Ministry of Science and Technology, Ministry of Education for financial support. Thank all of you for your time.
Okay, so please join me to thank all the speakers today. Next, we are going to move to the second part, the panel discussion. Please feel comfortable to speak freely. And let's welcome Professor Xu Jinbo and Professor Shao Yangyang to come to the stage. And also welcome online speakers, Professor Rothman, Professor Nair, Professor Zhen Anping, Professor Huimin to join us. So the topic today is to utilize synthetic cells to solve global life challenges. So anyone want to speak first?
Hey, hello. I want to talk about as I mentioned above, it gets easier to clone megabase DNA nowadays. So my question is, will delivery become a become a big thing lately? How can we deliver such big DNA fragments into a cell? For example, maybe we can look at how virus, how bacteria transfer molecules into specific cells. So will this be a bigger opportunity? How can we get started to improve the delivery efficiency?
I think Ronald actually provided some data on lipid nanoparticles, but he's not here. Anyone from our speakers or from the audience can discuss on this issue?
Hello, the chair?
Yeah, please.
Okay, yeah. So hello, everyone. I'm Huimin Yu from Tsinghua University. So it's really my pleasure to participate in the discussion here. And about the question on the, you know, global life challenges, I think, our scientist, you know, has some responsibility to do some contribution to this, you know, solve this problem. You know, in China, as we know, the cardiac vascular disease, cancer, and metabolic disease, you know, are the first number three diseases, you know, for deaths, causing deaths. So, you know, my dream, you know, is to do some research, you know, to produce some new biomedicines or, you know, to produce cheaper medicines using a Bayer approach, you know, to, you know, and finally, I hope, you know, these new medicines can be applied into, you know, the hospital to treat, you know, the diseases. So I think the synthetic biology is very promising to perform this task. And so I'll, you know, because my major is biochemical engineering, it's not, you know, very fundamental, I think, maybe. But I think the larger scale production is very important. I mean, we must, you know, produce more efficient, no matter new molecules or cheaper molecules, you know, to realize our more healthy and more better life. Okay, so I think synthetic biology and synthetic cells are very, very important to realize the better life in the future. Okay, thank you.
All right, probably I can add a few comments to this. I think Professor Yu Huimin made a very good point. Actually, I'm also a chemical engineer from training. And when we talk about the impact of synthetic biology, and of course, it can have really great impact in different areas. And the situation in the different areas like medical or industrial or foods will be different. But there's a common issue is really how to move from the proof concept to real application. I think most of studies in synthetic biology probably can see more than 90% or even more are really only proof concepts. If we take example for biomanufacturing, okay, you know, we need to have so-called process performance indicators. So for certain products, we need to have to reach concentration probably around 100 gram per liter and productivity gram per liter per day. But if you look at most of studies and probably have just milligram per liter level or milligram per day per something like that, it's a huge gap in between. But how to address the real problems, I think here is the issue. Normally, if you do at very, very low level, you don't really identify the key problems for the practical application. This applies for the biochemical compound, but also actually for biological compounds. I mean, even for medical treatment, because mostly we are working at far, far away from the real situation. And here's the real issue, how to deal with this. And, there's also many results are not necessarily producible or reproducible. That means the control of conditions. And also, I mean, this are quite important issues when I talk about the practical application to readdress global challenges. This will be my comment add to the point. I would like to support what really Professor Huimin said, and here really one key point, how to really get out of the proof concept. this one. So another is probably at one point, if we come back to the CO2 issue. Okay, this is what I'm interested in. I think also the project, their support or the society support is important also. Here, the issue is if green labeled compounds or products can have some benefits or can get some support. Otherwise, it will be very hard to compete with chemical process as well. Okay.
Thank you. So are there any comments from Professor Rasmus? No. Yeah, Professor Chen and Professor, you talked about the scale up things, right? So maybe you can talk more on basic science, like synaptic cells, right? Or protein engineering.
So I just have one question. So
yeah.
Do we have any, so my question is, so do we have a consensus on what are the global life challenges we are facing now? And which challenges now are being, maybe potentially can be resolved, say in the coming 5 or 10 years?
I think there are many challenges, right? But since the topic today is on synthetic cells, but again, the applications of synthetic cells is also very wide, right? From biomedicine to CO2 production, right? I'm not quite sure, but maybe from a protein engineering perspective, can you say something on this, on maybe biomedicine?
Yeah, so I think, I'm working on proteins, study proteins, so mostly by using computational methods. So yeah, we are trying to, design some proteins that can help us to, to deal with pollutions and also as well as, develop create proteins that can be useful for disease treatment, also diagnosis. Proteins just only some parts of a cell, right? It's just some molecules, and so I'm not very familiar with the whole cell system. Yeah.
Let's say, can you design snail proteins, Professor Rasmus snail pins, right? Something like that.
I'm not quite sure because I haven't studied snail system before. The proteins I'm familiar with are mostly, so for example, now we are studying antibodies and also mini proteins that can be used for as a biosensors and also for the treatment. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So Professor Xu, I think your work is very, very important, you know, for enzyme design, you know, in real industry. So I think it's very, very interesting and promising, you know, using your AI designed protein as, a real biocatalyst in industry.
Yeah, I think, so it's promising, to using AI to create some or to optimize some enzymes. And so, mostly we optimize enzyme using wet lab experiments, which is not, cannot be easily scale up. But I think by using computation methods, we can do a large scale search of the possible better engineering methods. And then, so I think we can scale up this kind of engineering. Yeah.
I have also one question regarding protein engineering. I mean, the AI is of course getting very popular. People rush into this area. So And people, I have the impression some people said, after 1 week, got so important results and can get, whatever, probably even better than AlphaFold 2 or whatever. So how can believe this kind of statements? I'm not really AI man, but I'm of course interested in using this, eventual prediction or output to design new pathways or non-natural pathways, but I cannot really, really judge this kind of statement. I mean, you are AI expert and I don't know how many years you are involved in that, but looks to me, many people, from the AI rate rush into it and give really very, very big statement. Can you comment on that? Yeah, hopefully judge.
Yeah, so, okay. For protein structure prediction, now we can do very well on a single protein structure prediction. But there are also some exceptions. For example, when the protein is very large, if it has multiple domains, and so we may be able to predict correctly the structure for each domain, each individual domain, but sometimes it's very challenging to predict the relative orientation of all these domains. When there are many domains in this protein, when the protein is very large, right? So this is one exception. So for many single proteins, we can do prediction very well, but for this kind of proteins, it's still very challenging. And also for a small portion of proteins, often proteins, by often proteins, it means, so this protein does not have, like say, brothers and sisters. So then for this kind of proteins, when this protein is not very small, when it has, say, 100 amino acids, then it's also very challenging to predict the structure. And so these are the exceptions. And then, so of course, we also face some other challenges, like say, how we can predict the interaction between proteins and the other molecules like DNA and RNAs, and even predicting the binding of two or multiple proteins is still very challenging. Although now we can do much better than before, but the results is not 100% satisfactory. Yeah, so there's still many problems to be resolved. And for protein engineering, I think by using AI, we are making a very good progress. So now we can say we can design a vaccine, we can design a diagnosis protein, but it will still take some time if we wanted to deliver therapeutic proteins. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay.
So actually back to the Professor Shao's question. So now we have a very good protein engineering approaches and also gene engineering, DNA engineering. So, but the delivery remains to be a challenge, right? Do you have any comments and from our speakers?
To date, we can clone the very large DNA fragments, and we can clone some complex disease-related genes or functional genes like larger than megabase. So now we have Cas9, but it can be used to correct the point mutation genetic disease. But as to the deletion or translocation of some abnormal chromosome diseases, in fact, this rare disease is not rare. About 1 in 5,000. It will be useful if we can clone such kind of corrector. A genetic gene and deliver it into specific cell or even we can knock this gene in the genome precisely. So I think delivery will be a big problem next for application of our ability to clone the DNA. So I was wondering if you have any opinion about we use some chassis cell like E. coli, like binding yeast to deliver and the DNA cloned in such kind of host.
Yeah, actually, probably the best delivery agent is a virus, right? most efficient, right?
But it has a very limited.
I know. So I mean, we learn from nature, but still way behind them, right?
Exactly.
So regarding applications, it's always like that. We have very good technologies, but we are always have some bottlenecks that we cannot actually overcome, right? So Professor Zhen is an expert on industrial applications. Can continue comment on that. So let's say we have a very good synthetic cell technologies, right? So if we want to use them in real applications, what do you expect we should do?
Yeah, there are a lot of things you should look at. I mean, first of all, you should look at the performance of the cells in bioreactor, if they can survive at all. We have very turbulent environment, right? We have very harsh conditions. You have to deal with raw materials and actually the real world is very, very hard. And even the single issue of to keep the sterility, right? You know, if the other cell, the question is engineer the cells, the most probably not have advances in the competition with natural cells to survive, right? I mean, these are also really engineering issue of you need to consider actually so far. I mean, the synthetic cells, that in my understanding, quite fragile. So here, how to get rid of stability. And also the degeneration. I mean, we have experience in developing really very, very powerful production strains. And after several generations, suddenly they lost their activity or really to very, very low level. And this, I mean, you understand nature has evolved the strains, right? The surviving conditions, the environment, and not the strains we are developing. I mean, they have such, what we are developing is actually more or less against the natural selection. So how to keep now the right selection reactor to keep your synthetic cells? I think we don't have very good solution so far, or not studied at all. Okay, that's my comment. I think probably I have also leave at 5 o'clock. Okay.
Okay, yeah.
I just kind of a comment, recycle things I just learned yesterday here. So to your ladies' question, yesterday, I heard a beautiful talk about the lung viral delivery. And so according to the talk, that's wonderful, much better than virus delivery. Maybe you can talk to the speaker. That's my old friend from in Shanghai, Liu Mingyuan.
Yeah. I really appreciate.
Yeah, okay.
Hello, everyone. Thank you for spending time with us today. My name is Sophia. I'm from Oxford University and Purdue University. So currently, my expertise in the industrialization of the synthetic biology. So for us, actually, the questions about how is synthetic biology changing the world is really closely related to what we do daily. So one of the typical challenges we have from the industry is, what exactly is that related to my industry? For example, when we talk to people from the FMCG, they'll be asking me, is that plant milk? Or is that, fermentation? And people from, let's say, chemical industry, they'll be asking, oh, why should we adopt that new methodology? Because it's more expensive. And can we sell that for more expensive? So that's why I think the leading academians and scientists have a very important responsibility to help us know very quickly like which industries will be the most easy to probably, you know, commercialize, and why that it will be the most critical. And also, let's say from, you know, educating the public perspective, you know, how can I tell my next generation, my children, you know, why you should adopt a better source of, you know, protein? That's my question. Yeah, thank you.
So can I answer this question? Yeah. Okay. So in fact, my research group, you know, has been working on industrialization of, you know, synthetic biology for more than 10 years. And our engineer cells have, you know, already been industrialized. And I think the company have already generated more than 1 billion profit. And in fact, one of our, you know, wholesale biocatalyst approach has already defeated the chemistry approach in industry. That is, it's more cheaper and it's more, you know, better. You know, we have higher productivity, lower, you know, substrate utilization cost, and so on. So that is, you know, the synthetic biology, even the applications of engineered cells, no matter cell biocatalysts or cell factories, you know, have already, you know, been better, you know, than the chemistry pathway in industry, in fact. So, but yes, you know, if we use the, you know, I mean, substrate such as CO2, you know, such as Professor Zheng is working on, yeah, that is a little more difficult, you know, in industry. I think maybe, but, you know, yeah, I think in the very near future, maybe the pathway even from CO2 substrate will be industrialized, and I think more cheaper, more better than the chemistry pathway. So, but yes, so far we are also working on some you know, technologies, you know, combining the bio and chemistry catalysis together for some chiral molecules synthesis and so on. But anyway, we have already developed at least three different products, you know, in bio pathway, you know, they all have been industrialized and produced, you know, very, I mean, huge profit. Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
So I think it's always like that when a new science comes to the stage, right? So let's say AI protein engineering, people always ask when it will come to the reality, right? To real applications, but it's all usually it takes a much longer time than people would expect, right? So the it's a very beautiful science. But regarding technological applications, it's always difficult, right? Like what I said, what you said, the delivery is still a major hurdle for the application of either protein engineering or DNA engineering, these things, right? So it's always difficult.
Yeah, but I think, yeah, it's true. Yeah, at the beginning, we do not know how to use the new technology, right? But gradually people will figure out how to use it, right?
Yeah. But it just takes time, right? Okay, so I think it's, we have had already very good discussions, and Professor Rossman may want to conclude, right?
Yeah, I in listening to the session, I was sort of, I realize that there's a confusion between synthetic biology and synthetic cells, and I think that's sort of a theme that Professor NEHER tried to touch upon. The idea of a synthetic cell with all that that entails is probably not on the horizon. But what we're hearing mostly about would have been called microbial engineering a few years ago. In fact, I noted that some of the participants are in engineering departments. It might be called biomedical engineering today. So those are sort of proximal applications, and we've been hearing a number of them. The one thing we haven't heard anything about that I think might be kind of important, but we used to hear a whole lot about in so-called synthetic biology a few years ago, is hydrocarbon. Probably the single, I think today, oil and gas are without any doubt major themes of our economies, and especially recently, the geopolitics has created very stressful situations for many people regarding access to hydrocarbons. Ultimately, hydrocarbons, the supply of hydrocarbons, the natural supply is already dwindling. And certainly there will come a point where there's very little or none left, or the cost of getting it out will be too great, because oil and so on came from natural one-time events in the Earth's history. So it seems to me a major goal for synthetic biology that in my mind anyway is really pressing is, for example, photosynthetic algae that are engineered to make oil. And we heard a whole lot about that maybe 10 or 15 years ago, and we don't hear a whole lot about it today. Maybe that's because it's too hard. I don't know. Maybe it's just too difficult. But I would love to see some consensus in the field to make that kind of a mega project, because the world will need hydrocarbon, even with alternative energy sources like atomic and the like, and wind and this and that. As valuable as those are, we're not going to be flying airplanes with them. And so I don't think we'll have too many WLA forums in the future if we don't solve the hydrocarbon problem. So anyway, that's sort of my thought.
So thank you. Thank you for sharing. Okay, so one last thing is that maybe we can take a photo together.
Last part, post award ceremony. Professor Yang Zhan Tao will host this event.
Check, check, check. 有请主持人杨展涛先生上台。
Good evening. Maybe I should say good night. Sorry, good afternoon. Good afternoon, our distinguished guests and all the participants. Welcome to the award ceremony of the excellent academic posters, the fifth WLA Forum, WLA Laboratory Series. I feel privileged to be the host of this exciting award ceremony event. First of all, please allow me to introduce to you Professor James ROTHMAN again, and most of us saw him in the last session. He is the 2013 Nobel Laureate in Physiology or Medicine. And so he is not able to come to this conference room, but he is in Shanghai and he is going to join us online. Let's give Professor Rothman a welcome. And we are also grateful to Professor Fan Chunhai, member of Chinese Academy of Science and the Dean of School of Chemistry and Chemical Engineering, Shanghai Jiao Tong University, and who is joining us for the ceremony. Welcome, Professor Fan. This year, the forum is the first time that a scientific poster program, along with four themed frontier research forums of WLA laboratory series have been organized for the annual WLA forum. This program aims to embody the WLA's mission, namely promote basic sciences, advocate for international cooperation, committed to development of youth. So keep that three mission in mind. The excellent academic poster session called for the submission from postdoc fellows and postgraduate students currently enrolled in academic or research institute to inspire and encourage young talents to share innovative ideas and research progress by academic exchanges and connections in related subjects. Within a very short period of the submission, the program received warm responses. Very interesting abstracts and posters with some breakthrough results came from all over the world, such as University of Oxford, University of Manchester in United Kingdom, the Lund University in Sweden, Northwest University, and University of California, Berkeley in United States, and also in China, Shanghai Jiao Tong University, many institutes of National Academy of Science, the Chinese Academy of Science, and University of Macau, University of Chinese, Hong Kong, Chinese University, etc. Meanwhile, several very senior scientists and experts in related research field have accepted our invitations, reviewed and evaluated all the submissions. Today, we are thrilled to have the opportunity of getting together and present the awards to our winners. On behalf of the organizing committee of the forum and the program, I'm very pleased to announce that award winners today. I would like to invite Professor Fan to join me to present the prize to our winner. Now, exciting time. It's like Oscar. So we have two first prize winners. And the first prize winners each will be presented an award certificate and a cash prize of 5,000 RMB, the Chinese yuan. The first prize will go to one of the two winners, Han Wenjian from the Innovation Center of Excellence on Brand Science, Chinese Academy of Science. Wenjian, please stay on the stage for a while. We'll have a group picture later. And another first prize winner, Yuan from Shanghai Jiao Tong University. Okay, let's have a group picture together. Wen Jian. Okay, please see it. Thank you. Due to the travel inconvenience caused by the COVID-19 pandemic, many of our winners and program participants are not able to come to this event today. But I'm still going to announce the second and the third prize winners right now. Again, each winner will be granted an award certificate and a cash prize for 3,000 RMB for the second prize and 1,500 RMB for the third prize, respectively. We will mail the award certificate and the cash prize checks to all the winners after the forum. So now the five second prize winners are Wang Yang from Southwestern University in United States, Ying Zhihang from Shanghai Jiao Tong University, Guo Chengcheng from Center of Excellence in Molecular Cell Science, Chinese Academy of Science, Han Yan from University of Macau, and Jordan No from University of California, Berkeley in United States. Congratulations to these five second prize winners. And next, we will have 10 third prize winners. They are Wang Han from Center for Excellence in Brain Science and Intelligent Technologies, Chinese Academy of Science. Yang Yudong from Shanghai Jiao Tong University. Zhang Chongyan from University of California, Berkeley in United States. An Ning from Shanghai Jiao Tong University. Xia Fan from Zhejiang University. Jiang Zhiyong from Nanjing University, Zhang Zhihui from East China Normal University, Sean Burnup from University of Oxford in United Kingdom, Liu Jingjing from Shanghai Jiao Tong University, and Wang Jingyi from Shenzhen Institute of Advanced Technologies, Chinese Academy of Science. So congratulations to all the winners. Besides the award certificates and the cash prize for all the winners, every participant, no matter win or not, you will receive a participation certificate later. Please do watch your mailbox for the surprise without surprising, because I already told you now. Okay, I would like to call your attention that this is the first time the excellent academic posters along with the four themed Frontiers Research Forums of WLA Laboratory Series, encouraged and supported by members of the World Laureates Association, particularly Professor Roger Kornberg, the 2006 Nobel Laureates in Chemistry, and the founding chairman of World Laureates Association, presented in the Forum of Frontiers in Gene Regulation this morning. He has also authorized his signature on the award certificate, so you will see it. And also Professor James Rothman, 2013 Nobel Laureate in Physiology or Medicine. He presented the keynote speech in the SEEND Forum of Towards Synthetic Cells at the scientific session we just saw. And he is going to deliver a specific congratulations speech to our winners and the participants. So now let's connect to Professor James Rothman. Welcome.
Well, thank you. And thank you for this wonderful opportunity. I will be brief. The most important thing I have to say is that is to congratulate all of you who participated in this poster session, because you are winners. Every single one of you is a winner. And the reason I say that is you have the privilege of doing original research. And that's the great privilege that positions you to contribute new knowledge and valuable information as you develop your careers in research. I particularly want to congratulate the first prize winners, though, because the two pieces of work that your posters represent are really the two sides the complementary sides of modern biomedical research, applied and basic. Work on programmable RNA base editing with a single guide RNA-free enzyme that you, Mr. Han, have engaged in Dr. Han, is a perfect example of innovative research that will likely in the short term contribute to human health, whether it'll be exactly your contribution or someone else's is unclear, but all these contributions bring us in the right direction. And then Dr. Huan, your fundamental work in neuroscience is an example of an equally valuable a fundamental contribution. We know so little about how cortical and other circuits in the brain function at the interface of behavior and neural circuitry. And you have applied the most modern optogenetic methods in a really innovative way. I've had a chance to read your poster as well. It's a little hard to see, as it were, today, what the practical applications are going to be. But the beauty and the importance of fundamental research is that you hold up a light through your contributions and others like yours that illuminates a whole way forward for many other investigators who will be doing research that has immediate application for people and for benefiting our lives. And you will create pathways for this research that otherwise would not even be visible. So thank you all for your contributions. It's a little frustrating for me to be so close to where you are, but be unable to join you for obvious reasons. Thank you for inviting me to join you in this fashion.
Thank you very much, Professor Rothman. Thanks for his comments and a very encouraging message. I would like also take this opportunity to thank all of our sponsors, reviewers, and the program organizing committee members and staff for your encouragement, help, and very hard work. Last but not least, we are very grateful to all the program participants and the audience on site or online. This program would not be successful without your support and the participation. We look forward to seeing all of you again next year. Thank you so much. And finally, I would like to invite all the members of the committing organization and the staff come on the stage to take a group picture. So, Kumbo, Zhiyun, all the staff, please come. To our audience, thank you again and good night.